Okay, good morning and welcome to the 29th meeting of the Education, Children and Young People Committee in 2023. We have apologies from both Ruth Maguire, MSP, and Willie Rennie, MSP. The first agenda item today is an evidence session with a panel of school leaders and representative organisations to understand how the curriculum is being delivered within the current framework and policy landscape. And we will also look at the impact of recent reports and announcements on the ground. So can I welcome, in no particular order, Peter Bain, who is Executive Head Teacher from Oban High School, Tyree High School, Tyree Primary School, Lismore Primary School, and President-elect of School Leaders Scotland. Greg Dempster, the General Secretary, Association of Head Teachers and Deputies in Scotland. Barry Graham, Head Teacher, Wallace Hall Academy in Dumfries and Galloway. And Graham Hutton, General Secretary from School Leavers Scotland and the former Head Teacher from Grove Academy in Dundee. And finally, Pauline Walker, Head Teacher from the Royal High School here in Edinburgh. Good morning. And we'll move straight to questions, if that's okay. And the first lot of questions come from myself. So we're interested to learn a little bit more about the freedoms that you have right now and the support to make decisions about your own schools and trying to gauge if that's consistent across the country and in all sectors of education. So I was wondering if you might, that's quite an opening question to get things talking, if you could maybe share some of your experiences in that. And will I start with Graham to the left?
Thank you very much indeed for welcoming us to the committee and whatnot and giving us the opportunity to speak. To answer your question right away, I don't think it is consistent across the country, and I think it is a bit patchy. And there are head teachers like yourselves, or as I was, who took up the empowerment agenda and wanted to take that forward. We, as a council, SLS, have clearly supported the reform agenda, and we believe that when you explain the why we need reform, then people will follow on. And that's what we've done in our schools over the last 5-10 years, and trying to explain why it does not fit. The status quo cannot go on without any shadow of a doubt. And with the empowerment agenda, we have taken decisions knowing the young people that are in our care, knowing the limits that are in with the local authority, and try to be innovative, be thinking out the box and take the initiative and taking things forward. We've looked at every other possible way of ensuring that all our young people get a better deal. The status quo, as I said, does not work. And it doesn't work for the high flyers because they are expecting, as universities will tell you, to be spoon-fed. And we need to make them think and be able to learn how to think and take things forward. It doesn't work for the middle 60, who we really have to, 60%, we have to really push up and make sure that they achieve higher. And it certainly doesn't work for the bottom forgotten third, who leave school without any qualifications whatsoever. And that is, for all of the head teachers here, really important that we make sure that we get them through and get them a qualification that shall lead on to a better quality of life elsewhere. Now, those traditional subjects that we all learned when we were at school, when I was at school, was even much narrower, standardised curriculum that didn't really fit with all the young people in care. In my school, there was no techie, there was no home economics, there was no biology. And we've expanded all these, and these are now seen as traditional subjects. But what I did at my school, and the same for Barry and Pauline and Peter, was to look at what other subjects, what other courses can we run that will suit the needs of these young people better. For instance, in my own school, we abandoned advanced higher techie because we thought the advanced engineering programme was a far better thing for them to experience. That was a project they had to design an ROV, a computerised thing that goes underwater in the oil industry, and they had to deal with the problems that erupted. The principal teacher of techie who led it kept saying, I hope and pray that when they put it into the pool for the first time, it fails, because then they will have to learn how they can sort those problems. And it's that problem solving, working together as a team, communicating with each other, learning that they have to do some of their own learning. For instance, they had to learn, one of them, how to program in Java. They had never done that in school, so they had to go and learn that themselves. So it's about making sure that they lead on to something else that will improve. And for some of these young people, and I know I'm taking up maybe too much time here, some of these young people actually got into university. They didn't have the qualifications, the traditional higher qualifications, but because they were able to talk about the experience that they'd had and the skills that they had, they got in. One young girl, and this is my last point, went for an interview with Dyson, and they said in the last 5 minutes of the interview, can we talk about this project you've talked about in your application? She talked for 40 minutes and they offered a job. Mm-hmm. And so that's what I think is where we are going with this, and ensuring that we meet the needs of the young people, because the current system doesn't work.
And I know, Graham, we are going to get the opportunity for you to come into more details on that in some of the line of questioning later on. I know it's a bit prescribed, some of this, but we're just trying to dig down on how you feel that you've got that freedom right now and how it can be, and the support you have to make decisions about your schools. But it's great to hear that you are making those decisions about your learners. Can I come to Barry Graham, please?
Thank you very much, and thanks for inviting us today as well. Like Graham, I agree is that they've got lots of different models across the country, but where it works best is where you do give head teachers that room to be creative and the resources and the time to be creative. And I think when you see that and you see it working at its best, there are models that are tailored to their communities. Maybe later on I'll get a chance to talk about some of the things that we're doing in Dumfries and Galloway, but it's about time and the resources to make those positive changes to our curriculum that help to meet the needs of all of our young people.
Do you feel, Barry, that there's, and maybe on the rest of the panel members when they answer, that you're getting the capacity for making that curriculum choices as has changed or improved over the last 10 years?
I think it's become more difficult because of the tightening of resources. So when you want to bring in new courses, there's a lot of training involved in that and working with other maybe colleges to help with, mm-hmm. with those things, and it's the staffing to go along with that. So there are very hard decisions, you know, because probably we've got a lot of similarities with all four schools, with National Fives hires and advanced hires, but it's when you're trying to bring in, you know, some more vocational courses that relate directly to the needs of your community, then that's a bit of a challenge because of the resourcing that would go along with it.
Thank you. Pauline Walker.
Yep, thank you very much. First of all, it's not consistent. I have the great privilege to be in a number of schools across Scotland as part of other roles I have, such as Associate Assessor, and it's certainly not the same picture across all the local authorities in terms of freedoms to make the choices in your schools about your curriculum. In my own context, in Edinburgh we do, and we do make those decisions to meet the needs of our young people, but it is constrained, first of all, by what is a measure of success nationally. At the moment, that is a points-gathering exercise. Hires are still considered the gold standard, and we're not moving in any way towards a more inclusive curriculum for excellence, such as referring to level 6. And that would allow us then to open our curriculum out more. So that does make it difficult in my context, because I have to be careful that I'm meeting the needs of all. So that includes those going on to university. Universities haven't moved a lot in terms of what they will accept coming through. In terms of success for my local authority and Scottish Government, what that looks like, because it's still very traditional in terms of the qualifications they're looking for. And then resources. So staffing is a massive issue. So the areas where we'd like to develop, where we know vocational courses would really encourage success in a group of young people who are a little bit disenfranchised by what we can offer, you can't get staff. So there's a huge shortage now in areas such as technical, biology, maths, business. You know, these are all areas where we have growth in Scotland, but we can't match that growth within our curriculum because there's a lack of staffing. So you are constrained, not so much at the moment by our authority in my context, but there are national considerations that are stopping us from growing. The reform needs to happen for us to take the next step, I feel. You know, I think I've gone as far as I probably can in my own context within the guidelines that we have in Scottish curriculum. And the reform now needs to move us forward so that we can take those bigger steps. It's about that curriculum for equity and excellence. So yes, we have to have our top 50% performing as best they possibly can as they leave. But what about everybody else? How are those pathways going to look right through from 3 to 18? And they're not quite there yet.
Thank you very much for that. Greg Dempster. Your comments.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, everyone. I'm different from the other four on the panel today in two respects. The first one is that I'm not a school leader, so I'm representing my members here, so I'm not going to be able to talk to you about individual settings and the work that they're doing. And the second is obviously that my area that I represent is primary, nursery and ASN schools. So we do a survey in AHDS each year, a workload survey, and we ask members about the empowerment agenda and how they feel about each of the four dimensions within that agenda. So they are curriculum improvement, staffing and resources, funding. And in relation to curriculum and to improvement, the vast majority, so we're way up about 80-90% of them, say that they do have an adequate degree of freedom in relation to those areas of their work, but or an appropriate degree of autonomy, rather. Those are the words that we use in the survey. But when it comes to staffing and to budgets, the picture is very different. And so there are well over 60% of members that say that they don't have an appropriate degree of autonomy when it comes to staffing, and a slightly less negative but still very negative picture in relation to funding. And so some of the other answers have strayed into reform rather than directly into your question, so I'll follow suit. So our members would certainly be saying, in terms of their empowerment and their freedoms in these areas, in relation to curriculum and improvement, that's not where the gap is. The gaps are in relation to resources and staffing, particularly around about management time within primary schools and ASN support and alternative placements.
Thank you very much for that, Greg. Peter Bain, what about yourself?
Hey, thanks, Convener. Nice to see everyone again. My apologies if it's a bit repetitive. Empowerment is something that the Scottish Government is keen to promote and has been for some time. We have the Head Teachers Charter, which is a good guide, and many of our members would like to see a reignition of promotion of that particular document, although there is one sentence in the document that the Head Teachers Charter that nullifies the whole document, and that is the ability of local authorities to overrule every other point in the document. In terms of consistency, I'm quite lucky. My local authority gives me a very high degree of autonomy and responsibility within the constraints of management circulars and local authority policies and obviously Scottish Government policy. I have the freedom to work with my local community to develop a curriculum that's appropriate for them. And as you know, I have four schools, and they're four very different schools in different parts of Argyll. Oban is very unique from Tyree and Lismore, for example. That flexibility and that autonomy does allow us, in partnership with the local community, to put on courses that serve the needs of those individual areas. So, for example, in Oban, there's a high degree of courses that are linked to the hospitality and tourism industry. There are engineering courses, there are hairdressing courses, whereas in Tyree, we use VC to access business courses because there's a lot of independent online businesses that operate out of Tyree, and so they like that type of thing. So that permission to do that is very welcome, but that permission is not granted across all 32 local authorities, and our members through SLS tell us that there are curricular constraints placed upon them where local authority management teams will have a strong veto on their curriculum. The problem with that is why does that veto exist? Why do they use that veto? And sadly to say, like the last time I was here, it is to do with the metrics that Pauline was talking about a minute ago. There is a need by some schools, by some local authorities, by some communities to ensure that the metrics of school performance are maintained. And by that, I mean the desire to keep hitting 5+ higher figures at the expense of putting on a vast array of vocational courses that would best suit young people in particular and individual and unique communities. is being put to the side to hit the 5+ figures. The second constraint is to do with resources. And of course, we are all, this is just naturally the case worldwide, but we are all faced with budgetary concerns for a variety of reasons. And naturally, local authorities are pruning their budgets, and that comes at the expense of pruning school budgets, which in turn prune staffing at teacher level, support level, and resource level beyond that. That's a difficult one to solve. The way to create a consistency, however, because even if we're all pruning, there is still an issue of fairness. Devolved school management, a DSM policy, the Scottish Government produces a guide for all local authorities and schools to follow, is not being followed by local authorities across the country. I'm lucky again. I have to praise my local authority, Argyll and Bute, because we do follow DSM in its purest form, and we allow what's referred to as an unlimited environment, so that a head teacher has the authority, the autonomy, to move money between different budgetary lines, which means if you need to put more staffing into your support service, because that's the nature of your school, you can do that. If you have less need for that, but you have maybe more need to put resources into your vocational provision, you can do that. More than 50% of local authorities have constrained the devolved school management guidance that the Scottish Government gives them to the point where they dictate the staffing formulas, which in turn, and the resource budgets, which in turn restrict the headteacher's ability to use that autonomy, to use that empowerment that was supposed to have been granted to everyone. So while I'm lucky and Pauline and Graham are lucky, it's not the case that is coming back from School Leader Scotland members across the board. Thank you.
Thank you very much for those responses. And I suppose it's a bit more of a specific question, this, and you may or may not all wish to answer this. So how do you determine the knowledge content of the curriculum that you are presenting? And how could national documentation support the better integration of different types of the knowledge that you've spoken about in terms of that curriculum for excellence? Who would like to go first on that? Peter? Or you caught my eye, I always do that.
No problem. That's a relatively easy one, based on what I've just said. It is about identifying the uniqueness of your community and talking to your community and analysing the market forces of that community and the desires of that community. So to use Oban again, clearly it's a tourism destination, so we're going to put on hospitality courses, and there's lots of jobs in hairdressing and engineering, etc. The market forces exist for us to choose from a vast array of courses available in the SQA suite of courses, and we put courses on, or we promote courses where we know that young people are going to get jobs. Right, to try and push them into something there's no jobs for is just not sensible. Additionally, we seek the views of young people and their parents over what their desires are. So there are many people, and I'll keep using Oban as an example, who want to go into the arts. There are a number of limited jobs in music and performing arts in Oban, but most of the time they would have to go down to the Central Belt or up to Aberdeen. So they might go to the Conservatoire, they might go to Aberdeen, they might go to Motherwell to do drama, etc. We know that we have a high number of pupils who have a desire to do that, and so we put courses on for that to happen as well. So you blend the knowledge that you get from doing the market research of where the jobs are, plus asking the families and the kids, what do you want to do? Because we're here to deliver dreams as well as just jobs. And that's how we dictate what our curriculum is. And it's as simple as that. And the legislation allows us to do that, provided that local authorities don't put any constraints on us.
Thank you, Peter. Delivering dreams, I quite like that. And my microphone was on as well. So, Pauline, can I come to you, please?
Yeah, I think within the senior phase, that's a really easy answer, because you're working within national guidelines in terms of knowledge content through the SQA normally, or through other course structures that you're using, and there's very little choice in there. The choice that does come in comes very much from your pupil voice, so really strongly being driven by what our community is telling us they need. That has been very much about global diversity and global issues over recent years, and the drive for change has been in there. Within the BGE, so first to third year, it's much more open. It's very much a skills-based framework. You can't develop skills without content and knowledge. So then the decision making has to then come about pathways. So where are those young people destined for within the senior phase, perhaps? And then looking again at local knowledge within Edinburgh, hospitality and leisure is massive. So there's a lot of drive towards there. And then you've got to look at recent issues such as health and wellbeing. That's been a huge concern for schools now for quite some time. So really looking at that healthy living coming right across the curriculum. So it's a fairly straightforward question, that one. In terms of documentation to support it, there's lots of national guidance out there, certainly for the senior phase. What I do find within BGE is it's a little bit fuzzy. So it very much can vary from school to school. And because we collaborate, it tends not to. But I think that's maybe where there could be more national guidance around where we should be looking within the BGE. Because, as I say, you can't develop skills without content and knowledge. So what content and knowledge should there be in there? And it's much wider and skills-based within that area.
OK, thank you. Does anyone else want to comment on that? Is that OK?
Just a couple of things. I agree with what's saying there about sort of maybe what we might call the traditional curriculum and the knowledge and understanding that goes with that. But we also have to add to that, you know, the skills that we're trying to develop in our young people to give them confidence to thrive in the 21st century. You know, and I think we all then try and tailor part of our curriculum to our local context. So in Dumfries and Galloway, I've got like an orchard that was given to us by Buccleuch Estates, you know, so we can get young people out there developing skills, you know, in growing apples and other fruit. We've invested in some polytunnels. We work very closely with the local colleges. We've developed courses, National Progression Awards in farming, where we've got something like 12 partner farmers, and our pupils go out every week to a different farm, so they get a real feel for different types of farming and a better understanding of what that means, you know, in 2023, the different types of farming, the way technology is used, the way that they now use research more than in the past. But we'll also then try and link that to sort of learning for sustainability, the whole environmental agenda, you know, and trying to make sure that there's a good understanding there, you know, of those parts of the curriculum at the same time. And I think it's how you work with your partners. You know, and we've found in Dumfries and Galloway there are lots of people that want to work with schools. Sometimes they just don't know how to do that and how their skills can best be used.
Specifically, I suppose, with the smaller businesses as well. They don't have the resource to do that. Can I move to questions now from Liam Kerr, please?
Yes, thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. I'll direct my initial question to Peter Bain, but if you catch my eye, if you want to contribute to these. Peter, just picking up on your comments earlier about the subjects and the number and the range of them, can you help the committee understand how do schools decide on the number and range of subjects, and is that the same across Scotland? And if that is done at an entirely local level, then how independent is it, and how much is it dictated by resourcing, the availability of specialist teachers that you alluded to earlier?
Right. The biggest constraint over the number of qualifications that any school can deliver on is the timetable. So the timetable, more than anything, drives choice to a very high degree. And traditionally, across the board, you may get youngsters in the BGE, so S1, S2, S3, although some schools have gone away from using the BGE and S3, but they would roughly get 13 to 15 subjects a week, and they have a period a week roughly, or a couple of periods of PE or something. And that's very formulaic, and within that, schools will use whatever free resources or whatever partners they have, etc., to try and add some interdisciplinary learning or some spice or some interest or some project work to make it a bit more enjoyable rather than just funnel the kids around 13 to 15 subjects. But sadly, that's what happens in most schools in the country. And so I would suggest that we should be reforming the BGE at some stage soon. However, as we move on to the certificated stage, where most people have an interest in because qualifications lead us to get our university college places and our job interviews, we tend to find that in S4, it varies between a delivery of, say, 6, 7, 8, or even 9 subjects, depending on how many minutes you give to each period. There's still the same amount of minutes in a week, but some schools choose to limit the amount of minutes they give to each subject so that they can eke out, say, 8 or even 9 subjects. I'm aware of 2 schools that do 9. It's mainly 7 or 8 across the country at the current time. So you reduce the time, and how you backfill for that is you steal it from the BGE, so you do less broad general education than you. But you're not supposed to do that. Schools across the country are doing that because there's not enough time to deliver the 160 hours per course that you need. And that's an SQA directive, that if you're running an SQA course that's at a national 5 level or a higher level, for example, it's 160 hours. There's nothing you can do about that. How schools then add to that is by usually an S5 and S6, specifically an S6, where the youngsters may have acquired 5 qualifications at a level that's appropriate to them and their destination. So if they're going to uni, for example, if they've got 5 hires in S5, we then supplement the 5 hires in S5 by doing a whole range of courses. So, for example, in Oban, we offer over 90 courses. That's across multiple levels. So that's levels 1 all the way through to a foundation apprenticeship level. And we offer about 50 kids at foundation apprenticeship levels. And that's thanks to partners. So we need Skills Development Scotland support for that. And we get direct funding from them to do foundation apprenticeships, for example. We need the support of UHI Argyll in our local area. They provide tutors to deliver national progression awards in engineering, for example, automotive and marine engineering, and in cosmetology and in health and beauty. We can't fund that all ourselves, so UHI provide that funding. So between the external funding sources from SDS, the support of UHI Argyll, and from my ability to move the budget, as I said, Argyll and Bute Council give me the authority to move my budgetary lines, and then I can buy tutors in. So I buy in music tutors, in dance tutors, in engineering tutors, in piping tutors. They're all paid from the movement of money, and that's what empowerment allows schools to do and allows me to deliver up to 90 subjects. But it's a combination of jigging the timetable to maximise the amount of hours that you need for each of the courses, thinking about pupil choice and deciding where in that timetable and when in that timetable that pupils can access that array of choice. And they need that choice. See, it's even the ones with 5 hires, that's not enough. They need the 5 hires, or they need their 5 Nat 5s, or whatever the entrance to the job or the college or the uni is, but that's not enough. Now, the unis are asking for the experiences. Great. I keep saying to the kids, see your 5 hires or your 5 Nat 5s. That's one key. That key opens the door to the next question. What makes you interesting now? And it's the personal statement, or it's the job application that says that I volunteered in this group, or I did these extra courses where I was a sports leader. So my son's trying to be a PE teacher just now, and he got his 5 hires in S5. But it's the fitness, the football, the sports coaching, the leadership qualifications that he picked up in S6 at the expense of hires. And I'm going to maybe finish with this wee point, because this is what's partly killing the curriculum, and partly killing choice, and partly killing opportunity. In my school, I allow that. Because my son, and he's one of many, and I could pick many pathways, he did his qualifications, he got his first key. His second key is the breadth of experience that makes him more ready, more work ready, or more uni ready, in his case, to be a PE teacher, that secures his position at uni or secures a position in the job. However, by doing that, the school stats, if you do that for multiple people, as I do, my school stats go like that, because they have less hires that they're clocking up. So what I could do is I could go, see all that extra stuff. We're not going to do that extra stuff because I actually need my stats to be up here. So I'm going to make you do an extra higher in French, or I'm going to make you do an extra higher in geography on top of your history and your modern studies. I'm going to make you do an extra higher in this, that and the next thing. Or I'm going to make... A lot of people are concerned about the drop in advanced higher numbers. Yeah, great. There's not that many people actually need advanced hires. What they need is all these wealth of experiences to help them get the jobs and help them get the positions at uni and help them make their way in the life. But there are still significant numbers of schools and local authorities going, why is your advanced hire numbers going down? Why is that percentage dropping? Why is it in the league table? Your advanced hires are plummeting. Why? Because few people need advanced hires and everybody needs experiences, and that's what we try to do. I hope that answers your question.
Pauline and Graham wanting in, Liam, so they both cut my eyes, just so you know.
Yes, thank you, and it does, and I'm very grateful for the answer. I will move to Pauline on the same question, but I'll direct a question, a short supplemental question to you as well. So that first question I asked, but also, if the secondary changes the curriculum, if it does the sort of thing that Peter's talking about, how do you ensure that the primary schools are sufficiently dovetailing with the changes that have been made at the secondary level?
Okay. Well, first of all, in terms of the curriculum structure, the number of subjects in fourth year, fifth year, sixth year is almost, it's a non-question. It doesn't matter. What you're looking for by the time the young person leaves, which in Scotland is quite often sixth year, they should have a totality of qualifications and experiences to enable them to be successful post-school. And that's what, I guess, Peter was talking about in terms of it's not just hires. It can't be just hires. It doesn't get you anywhere anymore. But also, we know from 10, 20, 30 years ago that young people were highly academic without skills, were not necessarily successful in the workplace. So we need to get that balance right. And that means that those experiences need to really build from all the way through from 3 to 18, and that's where we dovetail with our learning communities. So I have four primaries I'm associated with in my area, and we work together to look at the curriculum to see how can we build the skills all the way from nursery right through so that when our young people leave our learning community, they're highly successful. We look at the results, for example, of our leavers with our primary schools to show them where their young people went to show the trends and patterns that they're seeing, and to perhaps adjust where they need within the primaries to make sure that success is equitable and excellent. So there's a lot of work goes into that within schools across Scotland. So all schools in Scotland will have associated primaries where they work in that way. And that's how the curriculum in its totality needs to look. You can map a young person's journey all the way through from nursery to S6 and look at how they build the skills, the knowledge and the qualifications on their way through. Now, you can do that within general areas, for example, expressive arts, perhaps a maths pathway, a science pathway. So you can make your decisions to ensure those pathways are supported, but then you'll always have the random pathways that come out the sides. And that's where, you know, we've been talking about those other experiences that need to be on offer, which is why we have sort of 90 courses on offer to allow those pathways.
Thank you. I'll move Graham Hutton first of all, and then I'll come back to Barry Graham if I may. Graham, the initial question was around how schools decide on the number and range of subjects, which I know you want to contribute to. Whilst doing that, one of the things that this committee's heard about is the Finnish system, and that the Finnish system seems to have a great deal of autonomy in its decision, yet at the same time, its government is more prescriptive around certain aspects. So the question begged, given what we've heard already and what you're about to tell us, is there actually more scope for consistency on what should be taught in schools? So like the Finnish system, prescribed core subjects and a minimum time, whilst allowing the flexibility that we've heard about.
I think it's difficult to say because you can't just take the Finnish system or parts of the Finnish system and cherry pick it and put it into our system because it doesn't work. And that's one of the problems with the Scottish system. We've adapted here and there, we've bolted things on, and it doesn't actually hold together. And I think if you're taking something from Germany or Finland or whatnot, it has to be the whole system because the system works there. And there's also the cultural aspect of that's what they've been traditionally used to, and therefore there's a history there going back to how they got there. I think there is something to be said for saying that certain things have to be taught in the school without any shadow of a doubt, certain subjects in a way, literacy and numeracy, for instance, and health and well-being. But I think what we offer, what I offered at Grove, was far wider than what was actually taken up. And that's, as Peter says, following the pupil voice of saying what and your local circumstances. We were moving to far more sustainability because the sustainability industry in Dundee is growing. The games industry obviously is growing as well, and therefore we've done ethical hacking and games design. And I think a lot of the things that Peter said and Pauline said, I totally agree with. I think the advanced higher, I never really worried about my advanced higher figures because I knew I could double them quite easily if I had put in advanced higher engineering, but I didn't because we did the advanced engineering programme I talked about earlier. There was no qualifications there, apart from maybe if they wanted to get a Crestor award. But they got skills, they got experience, and that led to a much more positive destination for these young people. One of my young people who was wanting to do medicine did the first key, as Peter would say, the first door, got the five hires, but then did FITUP, which is fitness instruction training. And that's what got her into medicine and an unconditional, because she was doing that. She could then work out how the body worked, how the body functioned, rather than doing some other another hire, which didn't really add to her cachet. So I think there is more scope. The more head teachers are able to adapt their curriculum to suit the needs of the young people in their care, the better. And obviously there are local circumstances as well. When you're offering subjects, you really have to first of all think, what staffing have I got? For a while, I couldn't really offer home economics because I was too staffed down and I couldn't get a home economics teacher for love nor money. I couldn't even bake one. So it was difficult to offer more there. But then when I was at Braveview, we set up the hairdressing salon because we knew that was where a lot of young people wanted to go. And that took some resources, it took a bit of creative accounting, put it that way, to make sure that the money was there. But it was a winner because the young people could see that there was an end there. There was a goal that they could reach. And that we had a wee bit of flexibility there and we took it. And I think that's the key.
Very grateful to you all. Barry Graham.
Yeah, I wonder if I'll sort of address my remarks to the sort of the primary part of your question, the primary schools part of your question. I'm head teacher of an all-through school, so I'm responsible for the ELC, the primary and the secondary. And I do think that does give me the ability to ensure sort of clearer lines of progression. We probably all schools across the country look at the BGE, look at outcomes and experiences, look at sort of literacy and look at numeracy, but obviously there are different approaches there, and sometimes that creates its own challenge when all these young people, so there's maybe 20 different schools that feed into Wallace Hall, got some that are part of my cluster, I've got one school that's part of the school that I'm head of, you know, and then you have other ones from other parts of the authority, and they all come with a slightly different curriculum, and then you've got to try and pull that together and look at how you move forward. And the main way that you do that is through the outcomes and experiences, but it can work really well, you know, even down to the level of sharing the facilities that we have that a primary wouldn't be able to access, working on things like DIYW together, you know, and sharing speakers and sharing things around that, looking at approaches to homework, because, you know, different schools have got different approaches, and some of sort of going down an approach that might be that they don't encourage everybody to do homework, whereas I've got a different approach and I like them all to do that because it allows them to progress and allows me to sort of ensure that I'm raising attainment across the school. So I think there are approaches that can help ensure that there are clearer lines of progression, and I do think that helps as they go forward into the BGE, into S3 and into the senior phase after that as well.
Thank you.
I'm very grateful to you all.
It's a very... Greg Dems... OK, thank you.
It was just to continue that point. I think that working across clusters is extremely important. But primary schools do operate differently for different reasons. So they're responding to their different communities. So in a situation where you have 20 schools linking to one secondary school, that's a situation that's repeated lots of times across the country. Yes, there's an absolute need for the primaries and the secondary to work together to provide coherence in the learning experiences. But those individual schools are responding to the different starting points that they might have within different communities. So complete alignment is not always desirable or helpful, but coherence is something to strive for. Yeah.
Pam Duncan-Glancy, can I come over to yourself now? Thanks.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener, and good morning. Thank you for the questions you've answered so far. I think what the description that you've gave us of education in your areas and the parts that you're responsible for sounds exciting and definitely the sort of future that we should be gearing towards. I just want to pick up on a couple of points that we've heard so far. So, Graham, if I may, first of all, in your opening remarks, you said that the status quo can't continue. And Pauline, you mentioned that it was having a significant impact on pupils from poorer backgrounds. Can you tell us what it is about the status quo that's causing the problem for people from poorer backgrounds or disadvantaged backgrounds? And what about the reforms would change that?
So what we need to have in Scotland is a curriculum for equity and excellence, and we don't have that. We have a curriculum that's very much about the middle. You know, it's geared towards young people somewhere around the sort of top 50% who perform relatively well in it, get the right skills and go on to be successful. What we're finding in schools is that we have an increasing number of young people for whom that doesn't fit their needs. They have very specific needs, and it's not necessarily what the Scottish curriculum looks like. And these young people are particularly from disadvantaged backgrounds, who potentially have come from cycles of poverty for many generations, who are very disaffected by society. They see no purpose or point to education and quite often vote with their feet. More and more so because of poverty within the school. So they will come to school because we're able to offer heat, food, clothing, but will not go to class. And they'll vote with their feet. And the fact that they are voting with their feet in so many numbers is a cry out right across Scotland right now that we are not meeting their needs. Now, I can see it on a daily basis because they need something different. They do need access to culture, you know, to modern languages, to history, to modern studies and so on. But what they need is a purpose to see where it's going to take them in life, because they really are feeling that they're coming to do things that without purpose, I don't know why I'm doing this, therefore I'm not going to do it. So I'll just walk. And what we're constrained with is a curriculum which doesn't allow us to make changes to meet that need. So we need more pathways. So we need our national curriculum to open up, to allow us to make changes that we're not having to hide from the system, or if you have an inspection that you maybe move that bit aside a little, but it actually be embraced that many of our young people, particularly from disadvantaged backgrounds, have the skills and ability to be successful. And it's our job then to put place in courses that show them a way through and out of the poverty they're in. So that can be, for example, as simple as hairdressing. That's an incredibly financially viable pathway. It's very skilled. And many of my young people would want to do that because they know that they can then, within their community, go on and work within that area. And that would hook them into developing the skills around, for example, business, because they want to run their own business. They want to be self-employed. But at the moment, instead, what I'm having to do is provide an experiential curriculum within first to third year, which doesn't meet their needs. And then within the senior phase, to quite frank, they're so disenfranchised by there, it's very difficult to bring them on. Now, we are working hard to make that different, but I feel constrained by the current system. Even as simple as the stretch aims at the moment. So I'm expected to get every fourth year a level 5 course qualification and every fifth year a level 6 qualification. But those qualifications are very difficult to get in the areas these young people are interested in. So they don't. So they look like they've failed. so their success is not recognised or celebrated. They feel like a second-class citizen and they disengage further from society. So I really firmly believe that in terms of the reform, of course we need to keep excellence absolutely to the front and centre in Scotland, but we need that equity side now to come in and to the forefront. And we don't have that right now. We are constrained to be able to do that. Resourcing is a big issue as well, because many of the courses that could meet these needs are only available for colleges. So, for example, catering, the catering qualifications within level six, there's a number of them, but they require a cooking kitchen. Most schools don't have that. Most schools have a room with 20 cookers, you know, so we can't do it. So they have to go out to college, but college isn't their safe space. You know, they're not ready yet for that. They need to be within school where we've got support structures to help them be successful. Those are easy tweaks. So looking really at what... Where's the financial viability for these young people to get within their communities? Because many don't want to leave their communities. What does that look like? And therefore, how can we put structures and systems and qualifications in place to allow that to happen?
Thank you. I might come back to you in a second, but first of all, hear from Graeme, if that's all right.
Yeah, I totally agree with everything that Pauline said. And I think it's incumbent upon us to try and change the system. There's too much emphasis, as Peter said earlier, on the metrics of five plus at level five, at national five, and five at highers. The standing of national four, which is a very good course, is not high. And therefore, we need to change how that's looked at in comparison to national five. So if you've got national four, people think that doesn't matter. It does matter, because those young people have achieved something and they've got a qualification, but it doesn't have an exam at the end of it. And that's why the ACM worked very well in many ways, because it allowed teachers to actually measure what the young people had done and gave them praise and recognition for what they've done. The other thing we need to change is we need to treat vocational and academic subjects on an equal footing. Because what a young person is doing in hairdressing, and to give the example that Pauline, a higher hairdressing is, well, that's what they have to achieve to that level. A higher physics is a different ball game altogether, but that's the level they have to get to in that subject. So each subject, whether it's higher or level six, and I would much prefer level six, because we keep calling the highers the gold standard. Well, we left the gold standard nearly 100 years ago. So we need to look at what is relevant to the 21st century rather than the 20th or the 19th. I think these young people have to have a purpose and have to have a sense of belonging. And there needs to be pathways that they will see as relevant, that will take them to school. Why come to school? One of the things from the pandemic was, well, we didn't have to come to school, but we still learn, but we learned other things. It's what are we actually wanting them to learn? And I think I had a group of young people in S1, it was an article in the Times Ed about it, who really could not cope with school after the pandemic. And therefore, we got them onto a course using a local company, Quest, to get them hooked into learning again through football. Now, there was many years ago a thing called Kick It Kick Off in Dundee, and it was very, very successful. But these young people were all footballers. They were all boys, I'm afraid. I had a craft thing that I could talk about as well, where the young girls who were disillusioned, who were loners, who didn't want to get involved, were involved in knitting and kind of traditional female subjects, I'm afraid to say, but it was open to everybody. It wasn't there. But the football one was one that engaged these young men in improving their skills there, but not just their football skills, it was their soft skills as well. It was about being able to communicate better. It was about actually working together as a team. And as we came up through S2 and S3, I realised it had to be something else for them in school, not just numeracy and literacy, but also we moved to approach a company called Alexander's in Dundee, which is a decorating company who do lots of training, and we got these young people in to start getting a trade. So by the end of S3, they actually had their certificate that they could work on a building site. They couldn't work on a building site because they weren't 16 yet, but they already had a qualification that they were really proud of, and I'm going to get emotional here. They were really so proud of it because it was something that they achieved through school. Now, they were in school half the time. They were actually out at Alexander's or they were out at the Quest, but they were still engaging in education, and that is how we have to move forward. Pauline's right about the cost of things. That was very expensive, but you know, it was worthwhile. because it made sure that these young people are. So we need to look at how we spend our money, how we use the PEF fund, how we use other funds as well, creatively, to encourage better programmes of learning for young people that are not along the traditional. We're in danger of going back to the future. Actually, I think we're going forward to the past if we don't amend and change. Yeah? There's a tide in the affairs of men which, taken at the flood, leads to fortune. We're at that point now.
Thank you.
Can I, Ben's got a wee supplementary just on this before you, sure. you carry on, is yep. that okay?
Just very briefly, Mr Hutton, thanks for sharing that inspirational story. And I think it's important to emphasise, following on from what you've said, that while yourself and Pauline Walker have stated that these interventions and alternatives and innovative programmes are expensive, what they create in terms of young people contributing to society and what they save in terms of the Christie principles, potentially in terms of other services, is something that I think is important to keep in mind as well. Thank you.
I think it was more of a comment than a question from Ben McPherson, but maybe you can address that when you... Yeah, you would agree.
The more we work with partners to develop things, I think that's one of the things I was going to say earlier when, with Mr Kerr's question, is when you're building your curriculum, you need to think of what external partners you can work with. And I think that has grown in every school. At one point, we had over 100 partners that we worked with at Grove. And the more you can get other people in from the community, from the city or the local authority, the better that will support our young people.
Thank you. Pam Duncan-Clancy, back.
Thank you, and thank you both for those comprehensive answers. Do you think the current reforms will get us to where we need to be?
Pauline and then Barry. Yeah, okay.
I suppose it's quite a passion for me because I get quite frustrated at the pace of change. So the reality is the young people sitting in our schools now need this reform, not in 10, 20 years' time. And I really worry about what society will look like if we don't do something very quickly. So we need a timetable for change. I do think they're the right direction. They are very much looking at pathways, at looking at different measures of success, definitely looking at assessment. Assessment right now is horrific, particularly for our most disadvantaged. ACM model absolutely showed us that these young people are intelligent, they're skilled, they're able, but they cannot demonstrate it in the traditional way, which we expect them to, for many, many reasons. We disadvantage those who have ASN needs by our current models. So I do think the current reform is the right direction. I just think we need to go on with it, and move where we can in the quick wins and get a timetable for change in place so we can begin to plan.
Thank you.
Thank you. Barry Graham, do you want to come in on that thread as well?
Thank you for that. I agree 100% with Pauline. I think my greatest fear is there's potential there. We've had all these reviews. Let's get a plan. Why have we not got a bit of a timeline already, and we're having a bit of consultation on that and what will work? What are the bits that we need to get right? Involving teachers and head teachers and other school staff as well in that process. I think a key part of it is it shouldn't just be designed by people that are actually not working in schools anymore. It should, for it to be successful, we need to make sure that key stakeholders within schools are very much at the forefront of all that. And it's, for me, a biggie is to look at, exams and assessment, and that, accepting that assessments have got a bigger part to play in the future for us.
Thank you. Can I just press that final point?
No, I'm afraid I'm about to make a convener comment here, Pam, if you don't mind. I'm looking at the clock, and I know we've got a lot of passion in the room for what we're doing, but I'm really needing succinct or more succinct answers, and perhaps if the questions can be directed to individuals. I know, Peter, you want to come in, on this before I move to Michelle Thompson.
I'm fine, convener. Hopefully the panel will remember my very long answers on the subject of reform the last time.
Okay.
And if we could
we'll
bear them in mind
those.
Again. Thanks very much.
Sorry, the smiles, the energy that's coming from this panel, it's very catching, but I've got a timeline here and I feel a bit nasty about doing that. Can I come to Michelle Thompson now? Thank you.
I hear you, convener. And on that note, just picking up something you've already laid the ground for, Peter, so I'm going to come to Pauline, you first as well, and it's just finishing off that thread around the level of autonomy you have over your budget and in terms of how that then frames the sort of curriculum you can offer. What's your feeling now about the level of autonomy, and you may want to reflect further on the comments Peter's made in terms of local authorities and indeed the Scottish Government, but I'd just like to get kind of take a quick check from yourself, Pauline, and probably Barry and Graham as well.
I think it's a mixed autonomy. For the budget that comes to me, I have complete control over how I fire that budget. So if I decide to have less staffing or more staffing, that's my decision. That's in my authority. So that's very helpful in terms of making something that's relevant for me. However, there's quite a chunk of money which comes from Scottish Government that never makes it to our schools, and because the decisions are made by our local authorities about how it should be spent, and quite often it's on more, I suppose, global within the authority projects, and they don't often make their way to us. So it's sometimes what the Scottish Government puts in place doesn't actually impact on the ground because of that.
And do you have the same flexibility in terms of budget pots?
Yes.
Okay. And Barry and Graham, can you just reflect on that?
Yeah, I think I get some autonomy, but not enough autonomy. If I'm trying to keep my answer really short, I think I would like to see more autonomy to head teachers over the money that comes into the authority. Just as Pauline has just said there, to allow me to be creative. What I find is quite hard is that sometimes I've got all the money goes to running the things that I've got to do, and it's taken away that bit of creativity that should be a key part of a head teacher's job. I've just tried to keep it quite short.
So. Yeah, no, you're doing really well. Thank you. Graham.
I agree with my colleagues. I did have autonomy within my budget, £6.5 million, but of that, £5.5 million was for staffing. So the only way you could actually make anything was to actually cut the staffing in some way. But then you're constrained by the staffing figures that the authority have to put into the government because there's a limit. So that's difficult. I think in my role as General Secretary now, I'm hearing concerning stories of authorities where PEF money is being top sliced by 10 or even 15% to fill in gaps in the other budget, and that cost of the school day money or the curriculum monies, which are supposed to cover home economics, art and design, techie and drama, so that young people don't have to pay any more for their food and their wood. That's not going out to schools, and that has been put out by the Scottish Government, and it's not reaching schools at the moment. So that's a concern, because we are all using, or I was certainly using, the PEF money and the cost of school days money to make sure that we've got a bit more equity in the school.
And just finishing off this thread then, in terms of going forward, what you would like to see with any reform, I don't want to put words in anyone's mouth, but it sounds like you would like at least the minimum level of autonomy you've already got and that flexibility, and indeed potentially more. Right, okay, it's good.
Greg Dempster would like to come in on that thread as well, Michelle.
It just to talk about that flexibility point, I know you're asking in a secondary context because it relates to subject choice and things as well, but we get reported back a really broad range of examples in relation to how much control heads have over their budgets, from Peter's example of full ability to vire from area to area, to other examples where it's only an illusion of autonomy, where even funds that are devolved to the school leader, if they want to send a member of staff on a course, they have to ask for permission, even though it's budget that has been allocated to them. So there's a double decision making. It's been referred back to the local authority to say, yes, you can make that decision with the budget that's devolved to you. So there's a real spectrum across the country.
Okay, I think we hear that. There's another area I wanted to introduce that the committee's interested in, and that's of artificial intelligence. I mean, it's something that we're habitually talking about, and I just want to get a sense from the panel, how aware are you of the risks and opportunities that it offers in education generally, and how do you see a pathway forward for making sure that we, and who is that we, I'd appreciate your reflections, are equipped to move forward in that? Should the we be local schools? Should the we be local authorities? Should the we be government, or is it much bigger than that? So Peter, I'll come to you first, since I know you didn't contribute in the last thread.
No, that's fine. Honestly, I felt I contributed on that subject enough the last time, so it's okay. To AI, it is very virgin territory, and we in schools, I would think,
being presumptuous speaking for many people, merely because I've chaired a couple of meetings on this subject with collaborative groups, both an SLS and an organisation called Bosch. And we have had guest speakers who are more knowledgeable about AI than I certainly am. What we would believe to be a necessary forerunner to anything we do is for government to establish a degree of expertise and guidance that would guide education nationally through into local authorities, through into schools, and one that incorporates an understanding of AI, not just by the techie people, because sometimes when you're talking about AI to techie people, I'm like, what are you talking about? I didn't get that. Somebody tell me that in layman's language. And so we need employers within that. We need universities. We need colleges. We need a whole series of, or a whole holistic picture of society to have that discussion and understanding. Because ultimately schools, the job of a school is to prepare our youngsters for life and work. And unless we fully understand where AI is going in life and in work, then we can't prepare them. Mm-hmm. So we seem to need to be at the forefront of the development, but also we need to be at the tail end of the discussion. Otherwise, how do we know what we're aiming for? And that's quite a dichotomy, that.
Does anyone else want to add to that, Greg? Greg?
I've been involved in quite a few discussions and meetings and events that have related to AI recently. And really, it stems from the generative AI ballooning and being all over the media and everybody being concerned it's going to take over the world and kick us out. But really, the discussions that I've been involved in have all been about understanding the opportunities that can be taken from AI and how they can be used to improve the offering in schools, whether that's about helping teachers with consistency across year groups or across groups of schools in terms of how they work, or whether it's about lightening some administrative burdens. And so there was one of our keynotes at our conference last week, our annual conference, specifically about AI in education. And she had some really important things to say and some really interesting things to say. But core to her message was that AI is being presented as a wild stallion rampaging through education. But actually, the school leaders within their own settings, they have to take the reins. They have the reins. And first, they need to understand a bit more about AI and its opportunities, to think about how they might want to use those tools and opportunities to help address challenges that they've identified within their schools for pupils' learning, and then implement that and not be swayed by all the bells and the whistles and the excitement that sits around about some of those developments. So it's about defining how you want to use the technology and taking best advantage of it.
Any final comments?
The geek in the room.
Excellent. We like a geek.
So I think my worry is it will move so fast that we'll be left behind because we take so long to do anything. I think what we need to do is embrace, as you say. It's a technology which young people will be using quicker than we are. It's absolutely going to change our lives. It's going to change our working lives for the better. And we need to be prepared to be innovative in schools to be at the forefront of that. So as Peter says, we need to know how to be that because it's so new. But we're going to have to take some brave decisions and embrace it so that we can learn together as a society. And really, this is a big innovation that's going to change our lives forever. It's a bit like getting mobile phones. It's that big. It's really going to change. And for many young people, it's going to change their jobs for the better, you know, in the sort of low-paid area. They'll have a much better working life to come, I think, in terms of how it will move.
And for that reason, I think that's why we maybe need the national stroke international guidance about those opportunities and possible risks, so we can start to look at maybe things like where are we going to make the sort of marginal gains with this, and what are going to be the first steps with that, just to try and build the confidence, you know, of everybody that's going to be working with that.
Thank you. Is that a brief supplementary, Ross, or is it on this theme?
I hope it was the brief up to you.
Oopsie. Okay.
To decide just on the excuse me, on the point that a couple of you made about local authorities top slicing your budgets. The theory behind that for local authorities presumably is that they can recruit quality improvement officers and others who can provide additional value to you. But it sounds like it doesn't feel like you're getting a lot of additional value from what the local authorities are spending that top slicing on. Is that a fair way to read into that bit of your comments?
Can we direct that to Pauline, as Pauline did make that?
It doesn't reach the impact in the way it could, because it's too far spread. So when you have a targeted approach in schools, so the money comes to schools, you target it directly at the young people who you feel you can make a difference with, and it makes a difference. When it's top sliced, it's diluted, and it doesn't make the same impact.
Okay, thank you very much. And is that okay there? Okay, Ben McPherson, can I come to you now?
Thank you, Convener, and perhaps initially I could direct this to Pauline Walker and Peter Bain, as you've commented on these issues already, but happy to hear from others too. One of the key tensions that we've gone over somewhat already this morning is how to support a system where there's a great deal of freedom to enable young people to realise their potential and develop their abilities. But at the same time, to have a system of accountability and all the considerations around that in a scenario where Parliament wants to comment on statistics, the media want to write about it, and commentators want to talk about it. So, you know, there's been some criticism around too much focus placed on attainment results to measure success of schools, for example, the Morgan Review. So within those considerations, at the moment, who holds schools accountable for their performance and supports improvement? And so how does this work currently, and what would you like to see change so that this works perhaps differently in the future and better in the future? Maybe Pauline Walker first, if that's okay.
So first of all, I'm responsible. So as head teacher, it's a great responsibility that you have to ensure that every young person is leaving your school with what they need to go on. And so I have to hold all my teachers, my faculties, my departments, my subjects accountable through measures of success, so that I know we get, first of all, value for public money, but also that young people are being successful as they need to be. I'm held to account by my local authority, so I have a quality improvement officer who will regularly lift my results to look at a sense check throughout the year. And annually I have to report on how I am performing and whether I'm meeting the needs of all. That can be at the top end. I am an academic school, so I have a lot of young people who perform very strongly, but I also have young people at the other end, 300 or 400, who are in quintile one, and I need to show that they are progressing in the same way and getting the same equitable opportunities to be successful. So looking, for example, at gap data, our current measure of success is around these 5 national fives and 5 hires and so on. How do they sit there as well? There's also the inspectorate. You know, I've recently been inspected last December. Hadn't been seen for a very long time, 17 years, but when they did come in, that is a way that my parents and my community can have assurance that the school is working in the right direction, and what I'm telling them is success is actually what national success looks like. So there's lots of systems in place that hold us to account. I think you have to be held to account. I think that's right and proper. But I think possibly our measures at the moment are they're counterproductive. They're making us perform to the wrong areas of success instead of perhaps looking at skills or positive destinations or even just the word hire. You know, the fact that hire is considered the gold standard immediately makes the level 60s a second-class citizen. So by not changing that wording, you know, we really are, that's inequitable, straight up. You know, there's no way other way to look at it. So there are, I think that the system works, but we need to look at what the measure success would look like for all young people in Scotland so that our success is then celebrated. I do feel there are young people in our schools who have been very successful but don't consider themselves to be successful because society tells them they're not under the current system.
Until often they leave and begin working.
It's different.
And flourish. And yeah. I've seen that happen many times.
But they
times.
Should flourish in school.
Exactly.
They shouldn't have to wait 6 years in a school system to then flourish when they leave.
Exactly.
Greg wanting in, Ben.
Okay, Peter Bean.
Thank you. If you all cast your minds back to when you were at school and you had to write essays in English, I'm sure you all had to do that at some point. And at the end of that exercise and the teacher gave you your essay back, it was probably full of red pen or green pen if you were a hippie like me. And there'd be all these comments telling you how you could get better. But you probably never looked at that. You probably looked at the number on the front of the page. Did you get 25 out of 25, or did you get 19 out of 25, or did you just miss the pass rate or whatever? And the number became all-consuming, and you ignored the comments that would have actually made the number go up. And that's where we are just now and have been for decades. We look at the number, and that's all we care about. The 5-plus percentage figure that's published in the Herald, and then all the other newspapers follow suit, that's then shared with the parents and the local press and the elected members and the directors of education and then the HEDIs, the 5-plus percentage figure that, as Pauline referred to earlier, is really useful in gauging the academic attainment of those who are doing hires and helpful to understand how many are going to uni and being a success there. And for the other 50 or even 60%, depending on what school you're in, all the youngsters are going straight into employment and needing a wealth of different qualifications like National Progression Awards and Foundation Apprenticeships, or just skills-based experience that are going to get them a modern apprenticeship that's far more important than clocking up 5 random hires or 3 random hires above English or maths, for example. That's what's important. I agree with Pauline. We should absolutely have to go through scrutiny, and that scrutiny comes primarily through the inspector, I'm an associate assessor as well, comes through the HMI and comes through the self-evaluation teams that the local authorities employ, that has people coming out from various different schools, and they come into your schools and they do like a mini inspection and they challenge you. What we need to do is entirely change the metric, that's one that is based on measuring qualitative analysis of the success of a school in terms of youngsters going on to positive destinations and making a success of their school lives, and not these random 5 hires. If our youngsters go through the school experience, hopefully with the support of the partners that we've all mentioned, local partners, SDS, etc., universities, if they do that and they come out the other end better prepared for life and work, and we can measure that in a qualitative way and an individual way, and it is signed off by independent scrutiny, then the measure shouldn't be about 5-plus hires. It should be about a new benchmark that says the health and well-being of the children in the school is considered to be in a small paragraph, not a single word should appear. And that should give credibility, because it's external, and it should give a degree of comfort to the community that the health and well-being in the school for these young people are good, very good. I don't want to use a single word, but they describe it as being something that community would deem as a success.
Thank you, Peter. I am going to have to...
And so on. So health and well-being, literacy, so numeracy, etc.
Apologies, but it should be Peter. I really hate interrupting witnesses, but everyone is wanting to come in on these, and I'm... Before we move on, and we're going to ask, get you to answer, we are extending the session, because obviously we've got an awful lot more to cover. But I am looking for succinct responses, if that's possible. Greg and then Barry, OK? Thank you, Greg. Sorry about that.
I'll be more succinct than Peter, don't worry.
No comment.
I thought that Pauline painted a picture of the accountability system that sits around schools really well. Within primary schools with nurseries, there's another aspect to that as well, which is the care inspectorate, so they get the joy of 2 inspectorates. And I think this relates back to a recommendation from the OECD review about simplifying the institutions for clarity and coherence. So our position as an association is that you have that relationship with the local authority who are charged with improving the quality of education within their area. Now, headquarters, teams and local authorities have diminished massively over time, and their capacity to do that, I think, has been reduced by a significant degree. But I think that or our association position is that the inspection of individual schools and providing a moment in time snapshot with a summative report with the scores on the doors, like Peter is talking about, is not the way to improve the system. Once every 17 years tells you nothing, other than once every 17 years. And so our view is that the inspectorate should inspect local authorities' capacity to know and support improvement in their schools, not individual school inspections once in a blue moon. And that, I'm sure, would result in some pretty tough messages at the local authority level about the need to invest in that capacity. And similar to that, having two inspection bodies coming in on a regular basis into nurseries, classes and nursery schools is something that needs to be addressed and simplified. So there's one body making the inspection of those services.
Thank you, Greg. Barry Graham.
Thank you. I think we'd probably all agree attainment should be part of what's looked at, you know, when you look at a school, but it should be achievement and participation as well. We already have the National Improvement Framework, and I welcome the most recent change about looking at rights, looking at closing the gap, looking at health and well-being, and looking at positive destinations. So we already have within the system, but, you know, a meeting I was at a couple of weeks ago, when the National Improvement Framework was brought in, there was greater focus on that, and now we do seem to be stepping back from those other priorities. And I think there are things there that maybe we should be using to judge schools on.
Very briefly, Graham Hutton.
Just agree with what my colleagues have said. But I also think, particularly what Greg said about the inspections, I'm not convinced that inspection or scrutiny every 17 years actually works. But I do think that the role of the associate assessors coming in from another school who have relevant experience in what a school looks like and what that is far more valuable, and their criticisms and their support far more valuable than somebody who has been out of the game, you know, for a long while and is a permanent inspector. I'm sorry to criticise them there because in many ways they do a good job, but I think it's more relevant if you get people who are in the job with a finger on the pulse and know exactly what's expected. And also that there is a narrative in a school story. It's not just a snapshot of what they were doing then. How did they get to that point? You know, my own experience at Braeview, we had gone through inspection after inspection. We were under the course for nearly 3 years. But there was a whole story there of how we transformed the school. So it isn't just about a snapshot. It's what's the story of what is that school and those young people and the staff and the community gone through.
Thank you. Ben, in the interest of time, I am going to have to move on to the next theme.
I'm content with that. Okay. Just thank you for all those answers.
Yeah, thank you very much. Bill Kidd, please.
All right, thank you very much, convener. I just will try and make sure that you've got some questions that are easy to answer, so that shouldn't do any harm. I'll mention before, actually, having listened to everything that you've been saying, I'm rather sorry that I'm not actually going to school now rather than when I actually did go to school. Or I didn't always go, but I should have. Anyway, so this is me being quick, by the way. So, listening to what's being said in terms of concerns on provision of vocational qualification routes and a lack of available staffing, which I'd mentioned by Peter earlier, when you're looking for people to fill these posts, how do teachers and head teachers, how do they look at the change of perceptions of pupils and carers, and their carers, parents or whoever, around the value of vocational qualifications? Because, I mean, to my knowledge, it's always been you go for your hires to get yourself on in society because that's the only way forward. So how do you convince people, if they need convincing, that the vocational route is the correct route to follow at school, please?
I think it's a very difficult thing to do, you know, and you're absolutely right. There's a perception there that academic is good and anything else is not quite as good, you know, and trying to get people to understand that there are lots of jobs out there and lots of pathways that they can take. And, you know, I'm in Dumfries and Galloway, a rural school. I often talk about the fact if you want to be a dairyman in one of the the dairies, the average salary is like £60,000. You have to work long, very long hours. You're probably doing three sets of milking a day. You know, you're very busy, but you get a house along with that as well. So there are opportunities there, and it's a probably for us to try and make sure that people know of that, and like routes into engineering. It doesn't just have to be the academic route to Strathclyde into a degree. There are other pathways that can get you to that end point, mm-hmm. but starting at a different place.
It's a strong argument anyway. It'd be a good way of presenting things. I know that Peter's looking strongly as if he wants to answer it as well.
My very short answer is that we are blessed by having a great deal of professionals and a variety of agencies that support us. Developing the young workforce is a fantastic set of or parts of an organisation. Who promote vocational opportunities very strongly across the country. I was speaking to a guy, Klaus Meyer, who leads DYW for Education Scotland, and he's out busy working with schools just now, SDS, and their careers advisors promoting vocational opportunities. And if you have a brave head teacher who's not afraid of the metrics, then they will heavily promote equity and parity of esteem and vocational qualifications rather than just, as we were saying earlier, pushing them through hires.
Can I just quickly ask you then, because I did mention that you had mentioned a difficulty in getting staff for some of the courses that you wanted to run?
That's quite common, and that's both the more traditional subjects. In fact, I think Graham mentioned this earlier, home economics. It's very difficult to get staff to fill these positions. It's difficult to get maths teachers these days, and science teachers, and English teachers. But yeah, you have to be quite tailored in what you offer depending on who you can get. So I'm quite lucky in Oban that I'm able to employ engineering staff, music staff, dance tutors, because that's something that my area is into and there's a lot of these people about. But equally, we would want to do a lot more hospitality and catering, and I can't find those staff, and my kids are crying out for that.
That makes sense. Well, just on the back of that then, at last week's meeting, the witnesses suggested a decision on the future of qualifications shouldn't necessarily be waiting for an agreed consensus, in other words, for it to be imposed, I suppose. But it does have to emerge. What's the panel's view on this? Do you think you have to be able to break the consensus approach and that people can get a bit more local power to do these things?
Bringing Greg first, I'm just looking to mix up the members.
My comments are kind of as an observer who comes along to some meetings that relate to, lots of meetings end up relating to qualifications. There's not going to be a consensus. So decisions will have to be taken at some point because there are so many different and opposing views around about the best way forward. And it's just the decision needs to be taken and take as many people as possible along in that direction.
Okay. Thank you very much. Anybody else want to present?
The difficulty with education is everybody thinks they know how education should work because they went to school. And that is the reality. So I think there has to be an expert decision that takes the views of the experts and moves us forward as a society. Because the reality is you wouldn't go into your dentist and tell them how to pull your teeth, or indeed expect your doctor to still have the same practice as they did 50 years ago. We have to innovate and we have to reform. I think parents are scared for their children's futures, and I get that. I am a parent. And of course you don't want it to go wrong, but we won't get it wrong. We're a profession who are good at change. We're good change agents. So, you know, let us do the right thing for our young people. But it's going to take somebody to say, no, this is what we're doing. Let's move on. We will never agree.
Thank you. I'm going to have to move to Stephanie Callaghan, I'm afraid, Peter. Sorry.
Hopefully you'll get an opportunity to come in a moment, Peter. So I used to work 20 years ago doing an education initiative project for young people that didn't attend school. And I think, Graeme, you mentioned about going forward to the past, and actually some of that stuff was developing the young workforce, was actually the stuff that was happening there and then too. And Pauline, you mentioned about young people having purpose in deprived areas, and I think that's a really, really important point to take on board there about those soft skills and that engagement. So my question is around, you know, okay, we get parent nights and we get report cards that tell us how kids are working towards qualifications in their subjects and things. So what I'm wondering is, how is it that you actually identify young people's ambitions and check in with those pupils to make sure that they're getting the opportunities to fulfil those ambitions and have that flexibility for them to then go on and pursue the careers that they're really, really interested in an inclusive way? Quite a big question.
I was going to say, that's a massive question, and I've only got 6 minutes left in this session, OK? And we've got another line of questioning to come in, so please bear that in mind when you're responding. OK, thank you. Peter, first.
They are a key person who knows them well, who knows their ambitions, who can talk them through. You know, quite often with the young people, particularly from deprived areas, you ask them what they want to do, it's, I didn't ken, I don't know, I've no ambition. So there's very skilled staff in every school who can help them find that.
Graham Hutton.
Every school, secondary school, has a guidance. There's a question about whether there should be guidance staff as well in primaries, and I think there's a very good case for that. But the guidance staff or the people support staff should know their caseload, provided they don't have too many, and that's another wee issue about what is the caseload should be. But they should be able to see their caseload every day, speak to them, get to know them. There has to be, as Pauline said, a known person. SDS, involving them in every school as well, so that there's a lot of guidance, guidance and careers advice. And I think we've moved on from, I remember my careers advisor, I met for 5 minutes when I was in sixth year, and that was totally useless, and obviously guided me in the wrong direction, because, you know, I wanted to be a pop singer, but I can't sing. Anyway, I think there's a lot more advice and a lot more on offer to our young people today to guide them. And I think, you know, we've talked about pathways right through this. Certainly in my school, when I was there, we had a complete booklet through of full of pathways that would take young people forward to some sort of career. But pathways that are still, they converge off, they can change. And that's the point. There has to be flexibility still. But giving them more help, more support, more advice, and knowing our young people, and we've talked about this right from the start, you have to know your young people in your school to take them forward.
Peter, and then Barry on this one.
Could I just say as well, Peter, if you could just touch on the practical level, maybe what we need to get rid of and what we need to be doing.
I'll touch on definitely what we need to be doing. And I don't agree there's no consensus. I think the OECD, Muir, Withers, Hayward and Morgan are all very much singing for the same hymn sheet as was your panel last week. And I think that we should move quickly to an implementation stage of the SDA. And part of the SDA is on the personal pathway. And that would be an official measured ensuring a check-in for what you're describing.
Brilliant. Thank you.
OK, that was the previous question, but that's fine. Can I now move to questions from Ross Greer, please?
Thanks. Thanks, Convener. Quite a lot being covered already in terms of how inspections could work, which I think covers the new inspectorate aspect of reform. We've talked about the qualifications and assessments themselves, but I'm interested in the panel's perspective on what the new qualifications body could actually look like in terms of governance and structures. What would address the issues that are regularly cited about how the SQA operates as an organisation, but also the same question essentially again for Education Scotland, which is not being replaced but is being reformed. What organisational, structural and governance reforms would actually address some of the issues that you've been talking about? So if I could direct the Education Scotland bit to Greg in the first instance, because I suppose you've got less locus with the new qualifications body, but I'd be interested in maybe directing it a little bit, Peter, in the first instance, on governance structures for the NQB.
Greg.
You said Peter first. I'm just thinking. Sorry.
Peter, go for it. Sorry.
That's possibly the most contentious one.
Which is why I was looking for some time.
Right, OK. Right, reforming the SQA. I think that first and foremost, we have to accept there has been a huge amount of criticism over the SQA that arose during the pandemic. Basically because of the time delays that the decisions were taken over what to do with exams, and the whole profession felt that these all came too late. Now, to be fair to the SQA, it was quite a unique set of circumstances, and so you could say we understand why these delays existed, but they did come too late, and that did have a negative effect on our youngsters. What we did learn from that was that the ACM model worked for the schools who were prepared for it, And by that I mean that by not having exams, the ability for teachers, moderated by other teachers in other schools, to take youngsters through an assessment model that accurately measured their levels of performance, that worked. And there is a high demand for that type of assessment model in the new agency to be re-established, and that's come out in a number of the reviews. So that has to be a principal aim of the new organisation. It's not just a reshuffling the chairs. And that's the biggest challenge for the reforming of this agency. We're too busy talking about who's going to lead it and what's it going to be called. Is it the QSA or is it the SQA? And if we can get down to what are we trying to achieve rather than who is going to run it, I think we'll be better placed to understand where we're going. But at the moment, there is no faith in the profession at all for the reform of a qualifications body because there is no clear vision and no clear ideology, no clear understanding of the importance of parity of esteem and of the need to reform the whole qualification system to move to something like an SDA that's proposed by Professor Hayward's group. And until the vision is established, the agency discussions is going to forever just be mired in controversy. It would be my view and the view of many of my colleagues.
If I could use that to pose a question to others on the panel, what then is the role of the profession in the new body? Because a lot of the criticism, not just with the pandemic, a lot of the criticism predates the pandemic, including reports to this committee, is that the current SQA has been hostile to the feedback and input of the teaching profession. So what structures could how could we structure that new organisation? What could the governance arrangements be that would address those concerns that at the moment teachers are not heard by, respected by the body?
Be something I talked about before, and that was greater representation in the strategic groups. You know, make sure that you've got head teachers and teachers directly involved so people can hear about what's happening in the ground. I do fear that sometimes these decisions are made, you know, and people aren't directly aware of the impact of the decisions.
I was saying that, and having been involved in the National Qualifications Working Group for the last 4 years, or how long it was, half the committee were SQA members, who you not always see on screen. And there was a lack of head teacher. At one point, I was the only head teacher, practicing head teacher on the group, talking about exams. Yeah. So there needs to be a wider representation of teachers, head teachers, and particularly the SQA coordinators. I had a meeting with SQA on last past Friday with six deputies who are all SQA coordinators. And their complaint was, in the day-to-day dealings with SQA ordinary staff, it's fine. It's how the decisions are made and how they come through. And there's a lack of transparency there. And so a bigger role for SQA coordinators, head teachers, and people who know exactly. The appointees, they talk about the appointees are actually in school. There's thousands of appointees, principal assessors, deputy principal assessors and whatnot. They all have a role to play as well, but they could also have a role of influencing the way that SQA or the new body goes as well.
Craig, do you want to come in Education Scotland? I don't mean to cut you off, Pauline, if you've got anything on the NQB.
Thanks. I think that the key thing is, before you get to talk about governance, talking about roles and responsibilities of the organisation and being absolutely clear about what the organisation is there to do, you know, the new body. And it's really important that it's there and focused on supporting the profession and identifying gaps that the agency can get in and support professionals and schools and local authorities with. The outputs that come from Education Scotland need to be directly useful to schools, but the crucial thing is that quite often there's lots of good work already going on within Education Scotland. There's not the time to engage with it or the awareness necessarily that it's there. So that time to engage is an important part. And also, when we're thinking about organisations and governance, I think that there are quite a few elements in the outline that we've had so far about the Centre for Teaching Excellence that I'm not clear about where the separation or the differences would be between that and the agency for education, the new agency coming out of Education Scotland. And I think there's a lot of discussion still to be had about roles, responsibilities and synergies across those two bits of work.
See, just on
on the awareness point, and accepting that time pressures, workload are the major concern, but on that awareness point, that's come up quite a few times, and even not just with Education Scotland, a lot of the reviews that have taken place recently, the feedback you get from classroom teachers is, well, nobody asked me for my input on that. You speak to the people running the review, as far as they were concerned, they distributed all the material to local authorities, to schools, etc., and it just hadn't filtered down. So is there an issue with the structures that our national bodies use to communicate directly with teachers, or is the issue that the structure isn't there for that enough of that direct communication, and it goes through too many layers of filtering?
I think that the approaches that have been taken with different consultations and different reports have often been quite different, but you still get those same criticisms. So lots of different mechanisms have been tried. So I don't have an easy answer to that one, and I don't want to be quick to lay criticism or blame at those trying to communicate with the profession. The message that I frequently get back is about time to engage.
Barry or Pauline, you were both nodding away. I don't know if you want to come in on that.
I think that the normal way to engage with the profession is to send out a questionnaire to a busy person, and it appears in their inbox and it's there, and they might get to it, but you know, sometimes they're just too busy to do that. So maybe it's about recognising that's not the only research method in town. It isn't the only, I know there are other, but it's the normal way to start that process. But I think there are other ways to maybe get focus groups together, other ways of research that might give us a bit more depth to the messages that are coming from the profession.
Pauline?
Yeah, I think it's also looking at, I think there needs to be a change management strategy. So even looking at the flow of communication year in a school, there's no point asking secondary teachers in March for an opinion on anything, because all they're thinking about is qualifications, and yet that's often when a lot comes out, because that's the cycle within local government, for example, in terms of bringing change management forward ready for April's changes. So they need to look at when's the best time to ask, how's the best time to ask, so that you actually get the views of the system. It's very local dependent. Mine got lots of time to do it. I know other schools got none. They're really pushed for time. You have to take it from somewhere else to give them time to do it.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. If there's time for just maybe one more.
If it's one and it's directed, Ross, and then we'll have to...
Pauline, I'll direct it to you if you don't mind. This is somewhat arbitrary, admittedly. Part of the communication thing here has to be two-way, and a lot of the criticism of Education Scotland has been that they've produced huge amounts of resources that teachers didn't actually ask for. Some of which is good, others is not, but it's fundamentally not what teachers were actually asking for. How do we create a structure where the Education Scotland, whatever we rename it, its work is actually being directed by what teachers are saying they need? That element of the communication, the bottom up, if you want to give it a direction. What structure would we need for teachers to be able to actually be the ones directing the work of the body that's supposed to produce resources to support them?
It is a hard one because lots has been tried. But for me, you need to get practitioners together to work collaboratively across Scotland. And that needs to happen in a much more cohesive, advanced approach than it does now. Even for a subject change, you need to ask the people on the ground who are teaching it, what would that look like? And again, it's a change management system. There needs to be some sort of approach which works for all, so that we don't have decisions that are being taken that have long-lasting problems. For example, science, you know, National 4 and National 5, separate courses can't be taught together. Very challenging.
Okay, thank
Thanks
you.
Thanks very much.
I am going to have to draw this morning's session to a close, and I do want to thank the panel. I know it got a bit, certainly felt quite tense at this end as I'm looking at the clock, so I'm really apologies if that came over. I would like to thank you for your time this morning and the contributions we've had. I now suspend our meeting for 7 minutes to allow for a change of witnesses before we reconvene to consider our second agenda item. Thank you. Welcome back. And the second item on our agenda today is an evidence session with James Withers on the independent review of the skills delivery landscape. And we'll move straight to questions. And I was wondering if I could maybe put a bit of an opener there, quite a wide one, James. It's like, so what? It's been some time since your review has been published. So what assessment have you made of the response to that review so far?
First of all, thank you for the invite to come today, convener. I've obviously spent some time with the Economy Committee a couple of months ago, so it's so good to come and see members today. How would I characterise the response? I think generally I'm heartened. I met both Cabinet Secretary and subsequently have met the Minister a couple of times to discuss kind of progress around implementation of the review. I think there was an early signal that they welcome the general direction within my recommendations. I have landed them with a very big reform job to a very complex system. There were initial moves around announcements on skills planning going back into government, which is one of the recommendations, a single funding body as well. But in a sense, I probably, and this might sound a bit counterintuitive, I'm quite heartened by the fact that some time is being taken to look at this rather than a rush out to say, yeah, we'll agree all recommendations, let's go, because this is so complex. There will be unintended consequences. When you lift the lid on one thing, you find other things for sure. So I think importantly, considering what I have come up with is a series of recommendations for big structural reform and operational reform alongside the work that Louise Hayward has done, which supplements the work that Ken Muir has done, that Graham Smith did in careers, makes sense to me. But my one nervousness would be that momentum is lost in this. And the fear of anyone doing a review like this is the dreaded idea that sits on a shelf. I don't get the sense that is what is happening, but I think keeping up momentum will be critical.
You've mentioned you've met with some of the members of the Scottish Government, and they have published their purpose and principles document, and they've said that that's their initial response to your review. Do you think that there's anything missing from that in terms of anything major that's missing?
No, I think that's actually a really helpful document. One of the main areas of concern I had within the whole skills system was that there is no single definition of what good looks like. So I was asked to look 10 years ahead, how do we build a skills system that's fit for the future? My first question was, well, how do we know we have a skills system that's fit for the future? And the reality is there's no single definition of what good looks like and what success is. And in fact, probably worse than that, there were many different parts of the skills and learning system that had their own version of success, which didn't necessarily talk to each other. So I think the advantage of the purpose and principles document, it starts to set out some of the values that we're trying to embed within the whole learning system. I mean, I kind of identified within the report that whilst it was big structural reform, there were a few early key steps that could be delivered, one of which was establishing the purpose and principles. So I'm pleased to have seen that work's been done.
Thank you, James. We're going to move on to some questions now from Ross Greer, if that's okay.
Thanks, convener. James, you said already you're kind of somewhat heartened by the fact the government haven't just rushed into a response to your recommendations. Part of what you recommend, though, is, or overarching, is the point that this should be seen as a coherent package rather than something that can be pick and mix from. How concerned would you be if the government didn't accept your recommendations in full, and how do you think that should be managed if they do take a more selective approach to what they want to take forward?
So I think cherry-picking elements of the review would worry me if it was driven by what might be either expedient or felt easiest to do. I don't have a sense that is where government is going from my discussion with ministers, but the reason that I positioned my findings as a coherent whole is because what I was seeking to do was trying to build a more coherent system. And my overriding observation, which surprised me in a way, I was expecting to see complexity and some fragmentation, but the scale of fragmentation within the system did surprise me, having spent kind of 9 months inside the system. So my view is if you want a joined up system, you need to join it up, and that means all the moving parts. So to me, having a single qualifications body without also looking at having a single funding body and crystal clear approach to who's delivering business support and a crystal clear support who has leadership on careers and crystal clear support on who has leadership over skills planning, then you will remain with a fragmented system, hence the need for it to be looked at as a whole.
It sounds like the most important response is the CABSEC and the Minister. That has been broadly pretty warm. You certainly seem optimistic about it. What do you detect the response from within the system to be? Because part of your report is, I think entirely fairly, pretty critical of elements of the system and certainly of how they communicate and interact with each other. And we saw, you know, part of the discussion in the last panel is this question that overrides a lot of education reform at the moment, when you have the people who, this is perhaps an unfair way of putting it, but you'll get what I mean, the people who've been responsible for a system that is has come under a lot of criticism are then responsible for changing that system. If they're not bought into it, if they don't accept the premise of the need for change, then you can end up with the rebranding exercises rather than the more fundamental change that's required. So what response have you picked up from those who are actually involved in delivering the system as it currently stands?
So I think that is a very real risk, that you're asking the same agents to deliver comprehensive change who may feel criticised by what has gone before. I tried to position what I had done as very much a forward-looking exercise. This wasn't really scoring anyone's homework or a performance appraisal, but I came to the very clear conclusion that our skill system is not fit for the future. In all honesty, even if it was firing on all cylinders, it couldn't possibly be fit for the future because of the scale of change that's coming. I mean, I started this work September of last year. No one wanted to talk to me about AI. It's all they want to talk to me about now. So the pace of change that's coming is remarkable. I think that the response I've had from parts of the system has been mixed. So generally, a pretty warm welcome for the diagnosis. The prescription depends on, I suppose, your part in the system and what is being prescribed for you. I've met a lot of practitioners who certainly have an appetite for reform. And in fact, I didn't meet a single person in 9 months who felt the system was working optimally, and most called for pretty radical reform of the system. But I do think it's a wise watch out that, for example, if Skills Development Scotland is to be substantially recast, as I think is their potential, into our careers agency, a national careers agency, providing leadership there, which I think they've got the chance to deliver a transformational impact with doing that, that body needs to be in the mindset that is embracing change and not in any way hurt, concerned or scarred by the fact they're losing other functions. And ultimately that will be for the judgment of ministers, whether in them as an example will be in the right mindset to drive that forward. But I think it's a legitimate risk.
Thanks very much. And just finally, and I recognise this is a somewhat different bit of work, so it's fine you might not be across the specifics, the detail of it. The process and structures that's being used for education reform, to the setting up the new qualifications body, reform in Education Scotland, etc. Is that a similar process to what you think would be required to deliver on your recommendations, or looking at what's happening in that space, would you be concerned if that was the approach that we took to implementation of what you've recommended?
To be honest with you, I'm not close enough to it. My one plea would be that throughout the reform process, both on education and the wider skills system, and I spent, again, probably more time in the education system than I had planned to at the start of the process, but the evidence took me there, particularly in careers, apprenticeships, the future of the curriculum. I spent some time with Louise Hayward and the work she was doing, because there were very similar themes across the two of us. My one plea would be to keep absolutely arrow focused on the customers and users of the system. And I think sometimes the reform process understandably gets bogged down or disappears down rabbit holes talking to the delivery agents rather than the customer end. And what I tried to do in my review, and it, you know, there were strengths to it, there were challenges to it, and I've probably succeeded in some parts and failed in others, was take that whole system review, stepping out of the whole thing, thinking in 10 years' time, where do we want to be? And I think that kind of mindset and approach is critical. But the detail and the structures being set up to deliver a lot of the educational reform change, to be honest, I'm not that close to.
Thanks very much.
Thank you.
Thanks,
Stephanie Callaghan, can we come to you now, please?
Thank you very much, Convener. Thanks for coming along today. The report states that your interpretation of success is about everybody having equitable access to learning opportunities and being able to reach those positive destinations in their working life that can help Scotland's economy to flourish. I'm wondering what your views are on how we actually measure that success during the implementation period of the recommendations there. Is that qualitative data, quantitative? Is it a bit of a mix between the two of them there?
So I think the answer is it's probably a mix between the two. What I would say is that my definition of positive destination, it is defined by the individual and not by government or society. So as an example, I think our universities are incredible and that they are world class, but our entire education, skills and learning system is still dogged by the idea that university is the golden pathway, and any other pathway that isn't university is somehow a varying degree of second best. I think the pressure and the culture to achieve five hires, you know, is deemed as the golden success in school, and that leaves, in many schools, probably at least half of the pupil population behind. So for me, that is a system that is not achieving success. I think there will be metrics out there. I think, you know, university attendance across multiple different socioeconomic groups remains a valid way of measuring things, and I think higher attainment level remains a valid measure of success, but it can't be the only game in town. And I think in many ways the challenge of measuring other forms of success is that they are subjective. It's a sense of well-being, it's a sense of contribution, it's a sense of hope, it's a sense of personal satisfaction, and economists find it very difficult to count those things. You can count jobs and you can count grades, but you can't count that broader sense of well-being or a sense that you've reached a positive destination. And this is a wider economic issue, obviously, but we need to find a way of trying to do that, because at the moment what's happened is we've jettisoned a broader sense of truly measuring what might be a positive destination for an individual, which might not be university, it might not be a collection of grades, in favour of just measuring those things. And it leaves a lot of people behind, and crucially it stigmatises an awful lot of learning pathways that are going to be massively important for us going forward.
So perhaps asking young people themselves?
Yeah, that would certainly be a good start. I think one of the challenges for young people, and I think about this from the conversation I had last night with my son about what he's going to do, he's in 60, what he does afterwards, is young people at 16, 17, going on 18, don't really know what necessarily how they would measure success in life or really what they want to do next. So there has to be a continual monitoring of that throughout lives. And one of the key issues for me within the skills work I did was the need to take an all-age focus. There's an understandable focus on young people, and that is obviously critical, but there's an all-age focus we need to have on skills development and equipping people to maximise their own potential.
That's really helpful, thanks. So just following on from that, we did hear last week that, you know, there's this real need for culture change, and actually culture change takes a long time. It could, you know, take up to 10 years. So I'm wondering what you think is a reasonable timescale for that change to be embedded, and if there's anything specific that you think can help expedite that culture change.
So I think a 10-year horizon is not unrealistic for the kind of change and the scale of reform we're talking about. I go back to the point I made earlier that one of the real gaps is the lack of an agreed definition of what success looks like for our skills and learning system. And in the absence of that, I attempted to write a version of that, which was that, you know, everyone has equitable access to the learning opportunities that they need to reach a positive destination. Establishing that definition of success and ultimately a vision that all parts of the system can buy into, I think, will be important, because what I found was a system that was full of good people, full of people about passionate about equipping people with the skills for the future, but they defined success within their own particular lane. So those funding universities focused on universities, those funding apprenticeships purely focused on apprenticeships, and there wasn't a broader view of how the system worked together. So establishing that vision is absolutely critical, and thereafter this might be a long haul, and if I was nervous about anything is that public sector, I think, requires two things to reform properly, well, at least two things: time and tolerance. And public sector reform rarely has either. It's rarely given much time, and there's rarely much political tolerance, because I think the benefits of the kind of scale of reform that I think need to be seen will not be seen quickly, and that can be pounced upon by those who resist change.
So just a very, very short follow-up on that then. So do you think equipping the people right at the top of education then, the top leaders with systems thinking and systems leadership skills, is that something that could be a very positive influence?
Yeah, I think there's a dearth of systems thinking within
public sector more broadly, and that's entirely understandable because people are measured by the particular KPIs that sit on their desk, which tend to be entirely related to the particular role that they are doing, not a broader look on that. I don't see higher grades as necessarily a KPI we should be focused on. That's a process point. The output is what does an individual then do with either the hires they achieve, or if they don't achieve hires, what do they go on to? But I think what I tried to take was a whole systems approach to the skills system. It's not easy, but I think that idea of systems thinking would be good to embed in the public sector. And I think my final point would be not to necessarily presume that the public sector has the skills for broad reform.
That's great. Thanks very much.
Thank you, Stephanie Callaghan. Now, Ben McPherson, over to you, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. The review makes mention of other recently published reviews, and you talked about your engagement with Professor Hayward. So it makes mention of other recently published reviews and reports in the education and skills space. What are your thoughts on how the Scottish Government can best oversee this period of reform? You know, following on from previous answers about how quickly do we move forward? You talked earlier in your opening answer about how you were glad that some time is being taken to consider implementation, but there's a balance, isn't there, to consider amongst all of this?
There is, and in essence, I mean, Mr. Greer asked me about the response of, I suppose, practitioners in the system, and there's a fair degree of cynicism because life feels a little bit death by review. So there's some cynicism as, you know, what happens after all of this. What I would say is one of the real opportunities is to find the common threads that run through myself and my fellow reviewers, and you don't have to look too hard to find them, actually. So the need for a curriculum defined as a curriculum for equity as much as curriculum for excellence, parity of esteem, the need to recognise that the chase for grades is only one part of the system, and that maybe boiling 13 years of education down to how much you remember for 2 hours in an exam hall might not be the smartest way to determine the potential of someone going forward. The need to recognise that there's a whole heap of skills that traditional academic routes don't necessarily allow to flourish in individuals. So I think to answer your question, identifying the common themes and the stuff from Graeme Smith's work on careers, as well as Professor Hayward and the work that I've done, I'm less close to the work of Ken Muir, but those themes around parity of esteem, equity of access to opportunity are there and clear. The other key thing for me is to provide a lot greater degree of autonomy and trust to the people on the ground that are delivering. Now, in my sense, that was about giving regions a lot greater power over funding, establishing educational provision in their area, ability to work with business, a lot less control freakery at national level. A national agency telling an individual college how many apprenticeships it can have on a particular course seems mad to me. You know, give greater freedom. I suspect, I didn't hear much of the evidence of the previous panel, I imagine your average head teacher would welcome greater autonomy and the ability to be more creative. So there's a need, I think, to devolve greater power down to the individuals and put greater trust in practitioners to deliver what's appropriate in their particular setting. And I think, again, that would be a common theme that runs through the other reviews.
Thank you. So in those areas where there is, in those common themes that are shared between the reviews and amongst the reviews, do you think there should be a momentum that's, you talked about momentum earlier, that we should press on and make progress and change and implementation when it comes to those common areas, common themes?
Yeah, I do. And I think if take my report as an example, I think setting out a very clear aspiration that should be absolute clarity of responsibilities. So I found a system that was incredibly complex. I take great heart in it being complex because it's got an incredibly complex set of customers from different backgrounds, different requirements, different aspirations. So it should be complex. The problem was a lack of clarity. And having multiple different agencies involved in qualifications and in funding and in business support and in careers provision makes the landscape murkier than it should be for practitioners and ultimately for customers of the system. So I think there are steps that can be done. We're going to make the system clear. We're going to have a crystal clear lead around qualifications and on funding and careers and on business advice and on skills planning, but also recognising, being honest, that we are talking about cultural reform here as well. And that means the mindset of parents, as well as young people, as well as businesses and the system as a whole. So there are things that can be done that set a direction of travel, including defining what good looks like and clarity of responsibilities and roles, but also be honest to recognise this will be cultural reform and it will take time and the benefits might not be visible for some years.
Just a couple more questions, if that's okay, Convener. Thank you. Mr Withers, you said earlier that public sector reform takes time and please excuse me, what,
tolerance,
that's the word you used very, very wisely. That a common theme that we've heard amongst a number of people who've given evidence to us in recent weeks has been that the political arena needs to create the space and have the maturity to and the tolerance to enable the change that needs to happen. I don't know if you wanted to say anything further on that, because that's a responsibility that we and our colleagues share and need to be serious about.
Yeah. So I'm politically I'm an optimist. I noted there was a debate in Parliament around my review was part of the debate last week. I think there's a strong cross-party consensus that I have seen, and I engaged with most of the parties, certainly reached out to all parties during the process, that there needs to be reform is not up for debate. The how is where obviously there will be division of opinion. Purely as a political observation, we've got some years before, at least two, before we might enter another Scottish Parliament election. That feels like a window of opportunity before things get spicier from a political point of view to really harness that cross-party consensus and drive forward. So I think, while saying there's a longer-term cultural decade-long journey probably starting here, there's a window of opportunity to almost try and make the momentum unstoppable.
And then there will need to be a sense of responsibility as to how parties position themselves before 2026, but that's for...
The will, and just, sorry, Convener, can I just ask one final point?
You'll have lots of opportunities, sorry. And lots of points, Mr Withers, you're okay. That's fine, carry on.
This will require a strong ministerial stomach too,
yeah.
Because this is big reform. I've already seen parts of the system that I think were putting their defences up. I think complex systems evolve naturally of their own, and they have done that, and there hasn't been sufficient political ministerial direction of the system, I don't think. They evolve of their own, they don't reform of their own. And because this will be difficult, because there will be lots of people that will be able to say you can't do this because it will do that, it will require some real, I think, ministerial bravery to drive this through. And hopefully that cross-party consensus can make that just, make that courage a little bit less fraught or perilous than it might otherwise seem.
That's really helpful and important. Just lastly, some of the feedback I've received in my capacity as a constituency MSP with regard to the review is making sure that the needs of industry and the economy in a tight labour market, which is something we've discussed in different capacities in the past as a result of external factors. What engagement do you think needs to happen with the business community to make sure that what they're requiring is as well as young people's abilities is being nurtured and considered in this overall scenario?
So this really comes back to the theme in my work around regionalisation and giving greater autonomy to individual areas to drive forward the establishment of educational provision and actually just shaping the kind of frameworks and qualifications that are developed. Where I got to was, I think the DYW network is great. I think it's got real potential. I think it's still a story of unrealised potential. I wanted to see a network of regional employer boards established and a national employers board to help shape the entire learning system. One of my recommendations, which has proved quite, controversial for those that currently perform this role, which is the apprenticeship approval, so the SAB, which I've suggested should be wound up, not because it hasn't done its job, but because it has proved that you can have employers shaping a part of the system, but unfortunately the apprenticeship system has been carved out from the rest, put over here, hasn't been mainstreamed. So I've suggested wind that function down and embed the principle of employer involvement in shaping our learning framework into every single part of the learning system, not just apprenticeship. So that's why I'd like to see the DYW boards resourced and taken on more responsibility to really drive that at a regional level. And actually what I'd also like to see, and again, you know, there'll be different views in the DYW, personally I'd like to see the Y dropped from DYW. I think they've got potential actually to help shape the system for all ages, not just young people. And I think that there's huge potential in using that as a mechanism for business and industry to help shape the future of the whole skills system.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener. Thank you.
Michelle Thompson, thank you very much.
Thank you, Convener, and thank you for joining us this morning. You used a term earlier, death by review, I think I'm right. Do you have any concerns that your review will get lost in the multitude of other very worthwhile reviews and documents as the time by necessity is taken to look at them?
Yes, because it's happened before. Mm-hmm. And I've spoken to people that have done reviews like this. I've been involved in reviews like this before, and they fall by the wayside because priorities change, events arise. My instinct says there is enough commonality across the reviews and enough general momentum that the system has to change because of what's happening out there and change in economy and society and technology and the new industrial revolution and all of that, that there is no longer a question about whether there should be reform, it's just how it's done. So I'd be lying if I didn't have a human fear that you do all this work and it ends up not going anywhere. All I can do is take in good faith what I've been told by ministers, and actually what I've heard probably from a lot of people involved in the delivery of system, that there's enough in here in the work that I've done alongside the work of many others and those who came before me to create momentum that might be unstoppable. But yeah, I've certainly had dark moments where I think I might have wasted 9 months of my life, but hopefully not.
Thank you for that. And just touching on something else, we've talked a wee bit about the kind of political, where we are in the political cycle, and you've mentioned the phrase time and tolerance. How do you square off time and tolerance, as you've already expressed, against the urgency that you undeniably put across both today and in your report? How do you start to square that off, bearing in mind that we have a political cycle and all the other potential barriers and resistance to change?
It's an incredibly difficult balancing act, and I'm not sure you can square it off. You need to make a judgment as to whether you're willing to, I suppose, maybe sacrifice some progress in the short term because there's a bigger, longer term dividend out there that can be grasped. As I say, you know, I identified kind of five early steps that I felt government could do around developing the purpose and principles, getting the new skills planning process motoring embedded in government, determining a new model for funding to embed equity of access and parity of esteem, carry out an audit of qualifications, which are a mess of terminology. I mean, again, personal, but helping my son choose his sixth-year courses, it's an alphabet soup of acronyms between, you know, MPAs and FAs and SFGs and hires and advanced hires. These are all beautifully mapped out on the SCQF framework, levels 1 through to, you know, 10, 11. How on earth we've managed to not use that framework and not refer to level 6, level 7, and instead come up with different terms blows my mind, to be honest. And that's one of the solutions sat there. I think we could be embracing that, establishing these employer boards. So I think there are steps that can be done quickly, but within overarching framework and definition of what good looks like. So while we're doing individual areas of improvement or implementation, there's an understanding of how that feeds into the longer term. So you try and stitch together that need to the urgency of action versus a longer term game that this is. That's the only mechanism I would use to stitch the two together. Identify what you can do quickly, but be crystal clear how that feeds into the broader, maybe decade long journey.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you very much, Michelle. Can I come to Pam Duncan-Glancy now, please?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning. I think it still is, yes. And thank you for answering the questions so far and the work you've put into your report. I'm going to start with questions a bit on the same theme that we've discussed there, kind of on leadership and reform, and then move to funding. How do you believe the Scottish Government taking responsibility for skills planning can bring about the required culture change needed?
So I think there's an important point around skills planning, and I would divide it into a game of two halves. I think there is a need to, and it's a difficult challenge, but there's a need to identify some critical national priorities that are relevant for all parts of Scotland. So some critical areas of skills planning, which every part of the country will need to respond to. I haven't said what they are. There'll be different views on that, whether it's net zero, green skills, whether it's digital. But beyond that, release the regions to do the rest. So there may be two or three national priorities, and we'd expect all parts of the country to respond to that and develop their version of skills plans to respond to that. But beyond that, release regions. And my instinct was that now that we've got city-region deals and we've got eight economic regional partnerships in place, use them. If we're trusting them with to manage billions of pounds of investment, I think we can trust them with the skills plan that sits alongside that, and free them up to determine what the plans look like. So the balance between national and regional, for me, is that I don't think Scotland is big enough to have 32 or even 8 different skills frameworks. I think there should be a national framework, but the detail of that could then be really driven in regional areas, and I don't think there's enough autonomy at that regional level at the moment. So I think there's an element of leadership at national level around the two or three priorities, and that's a tough call, because if you get them wrong, you know, you'll get hammered, and that's difficult, saying pick three, you know, winners. But after that, you're not jettisoning everything else. You can focus on individual elements. So hospitality is important to Highlands and Islands, Argyll and Bute, because of the tourism industry. Let them develop their plan on that, working with businesses and colleges and others, but get that balance between national and regional, if that answers the question.
It does, thank you. I appreciate that. And on a similar vein, do you agree with University Scotland, for example, that some of the changes you've suggested, including what you've just described, can happen without legislative change, and what can be done to sort of what decisions could be taken around funding work-based learning, for example, or upskilling and reskilling now without legislative change?
Yes, I do. So I think skills planning doesn't require legislative change, and I'm no legislative expert. Clearly, to establish a single qualifications body and funding body, I've suggested that a recast SDS should move to be founded into legislation, which it isn't at the moment, to deliver careers. Some of that will require legislation, but some of the cultural pieces around levels of autonomy, thresholds for authority, and that releasing the regions to crack on doesn't require legislative framework in my mind anyway. It's more about a way of working that changes.
And that could be done quite quickly, you think?
Yes, and I think, yeah, I mean, in a sense, one of the things, I think the first things government talked about was bringing the skills planning would be brought in-house. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot of skills planning work happening. So what I would say is there are good skills plans in place. You know, look in the south of Scotland, who have done great work with South Scotland Enterprise, with SDS, with other agencies, with colleges. There are good plans in place. Don't torch them or put them in the bin. They can crack on. But where there needs to be greater autonomy to help deliver some of that, then yes, I think that could be done. But it does require a real mindset and, to some extent, again, some political bravery to release the reins a little bit and trust those on the ground to make some of those decisions and recognise that when you do that, some things will go wrong. It's guaranteed they will go wrong, but the overall benefit will outweigh the odd case study where maybe stewardship of money hasn't been absolutely perfect.
Thank you. And I suppose that kind of links back to your point about ministerial stomach, which I think is important. Can I move on now to ask about the role of colleges and universities and funding in that space? Colleges Scotland have said that the skills framework that you've outlined and skills in general in Scotland rely on a strong college sector. Would you agree with that?
I would. So I had worked in and around the skills system for maybe 15, 20 years. In quite a narrow lane of it, though. So from a perspective of business and working for trade bodies, there were large parts of the system that I didn't know in depth that I've got to know over the last 9 months. The college sector would be in that category. I've been blown away by the potential of the college sector. I spent time inside colleges.
and I was excited, enthused, came away buzzing at their potential, you know, rooted in their communities, connected to businesses, well connected to high schools, delivering real practical skills and learning to individuals who the old and still existing view might have been that they somehow academically had failed because they hadn't collected a bunch of grades. The potential of that college sector was phenomenal. I do worry about that sector. There's a burning platform there for them around finance and sustainability. I do worry that we might see a more chaotic reorganisation of that sector based on almost a law of natural selection, who's most vulnerable, who might fall, who might not, and that might need to be looked at in time. But I see, given where the economy is going, given what businesses have told me and what I've seen about the skills that are required, the college sector is an absolute jewel in our crown, and the more we can do to support it and crucially embed it in the heart of regional skills planning, and I met some colleges who felt they weren't around that table, and the more we can do that, I think the better. I think it's a huge asset.
I share your concerns around the funding of that, and what colleges also share with universities are concern around the funding. So University of Scotland, for example, have said that it's not necessarily the methodology that's the problem, it's the fact that university places for Scottish domicile students are chronically underfunded in Scotland, and their reliance on international students is becoming more and more, and of course the numbers coming to Scotland internationally are dropping. Does that context for universities and colleges concern you in terms of the skills for the future?
The whole funding piece was a really interesting area for me because I suppose it would be fair to say that when I was appointed to do this, I was given a very, very free hand. There was an underlying message, don't come back with something that's going to cost a lot more. Okay, so now that's entirely understandable given that the kind of fiscal position we're in. That said, we spend 3.2 billion every year in this whole area, which must be 5-7% of the Parliament or government's entire budget. So I don't think the problem is underinvestment in this whole area, but I think there is duplication and there are inefficiencies in the system. That said, you know, you can't ignore the fact that you've got a line of university principals and staff and college principal staff that are worried about funding. I think there's more that can be done to release some of the shackles. I think universities should be free to determine, for example, how much of their provision they want to put into full-time education versus delivering graduate apprenticeships and delivering degree apprenticeships through not full-time education, but a kind of earn and learn approach. And at the moment, graduate apprenticeships are kind of capped every year. Their funding's uncertain. They're separated off into a different kind of system. Why don't we trust universities to be able to use that funding as they so wish? So I think the elements could be released, but I think, like probably every sector of the learning education system, probably every sector of the economy, funding is a concern going forward.
And then just one final question on the duplication. What duplication in the system did you notice?
So I think it comes back to the lack of clarity that you had multiple different agencies involved in qualifications development, in funding of itself, in the development of some of the educational frameworks. If you are a business at the moment and you're interested in workforce development, it can be difficult to know whether you go to Business Gateway, Local Enterprise, Job Centre Plus, Skills Development Scotland. So I think there is naturally duplication in the system, not born of any bad intent, but of a system that's been allowed to evolve, and a system that is fragmented and doesn't collaborate as tightly as it could, and through a lack of political direction to shape the system.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Do you want a supplementary on this, Stephanie Callaghan?
Yes, if I could. Thank you, Convener. So just going back to something that you said earlier, James, about, you know, you have to accept that things can go wrong when you're talking about handing that power down regionally there as well. And it just makes me think right away about politically ministerial accountability for it as well. And I'm just wondering what your thoughts are around that. Is there a kind of, I suppose, like aeroplanes when they crash, you know, it's a team going in there to look at why that actually happened. I'm wondering if there's anything from your business background that you could say that's the kind of direction of it, that the accountability wouldn't be an issue.
I think it's just, I mean, business culture versus political culture obviously is often very different. You know, you speak to most business schools and they talk about permission to make mistakes. You learn more from your mistakes than you do your successes. And it might be incredibly naive to say that in any way, you know, we could achieve a system politically that would allow for that. Certainly, if I was the accountable officer for a major agency, you know, I would certainly live in a perpetual fear of terror that something goes wrong, that I'm in front of the audit committee or a committee being scrutinised as to why did money over here not deliver what it was supposed to, or, you know, worst, end up in the wrong place. And that's just a way of life. I think my observation would be that overall, the benefits that will be achieved by putting greater trust into the people that are actually delivering things on the ground and that are connected into business and college and universities will far outweigh the problem. But obviously we live in a place where there's more political and media scrutiny on the bits that go wrong. So I might just be incredibly naive.
Thank you, Stephanie. Now, thank you. Can we move to Liam Kerr now, please?
Yes, thanks, Convener. Good morning, Mr. Withers. On a similar topic, actually, one of your structural recommendations was the establishment of a single funding body, which would cover the SDS, the SFC, and potentially SAS. And the rationale for doing that was, I think you said there was a fragmented system at the moment which is impacting the ability of providers to deliver. So what are the risks, as you see them then, of not going forward with a single funding body?
So I'll use apprenticeships probably as an example that I think is an incredibly important part of the whole learning system. I think that in order to establish apprenticeships as that critical part of our learning system, it required a distinct focus. I think it required distinct funding, and it probably required distinct agency ownership to establish it. I think it's exactly those things that are now holding it back. So as long as apprenticeships, for example, remain carved out from our whole wider learning system, and are put over here with a separate agency with separate funding, separate KPIs, uncertain annual funding, it will remain separate from the system and it will not be mainstreamed. So dividing university, college and funding into one agency in SFC and apprenticeship and training funding into SDS, to me, crystallises a false divide between what we call at the moment education and vocation. The idea that education delivers learning and vocation delivers skills, where in reality the position is much more nuanced. Education clearly delivers skills for the workplace, and vocational routes clearly deliver broader learning on problem solving, innovation, and other things as well. So my view, I suppose, glibly, is if you want a joined up system, you need to join it up. And having funding brought together into one place makes sense. There are real risks in that, though. So one of the risks I would identify is that unless you have a culture that recognises the enormous value of apprenticeships, for example, putting that inside a body that maybe has hitherto largely looked after university funding as one large part, there's a risk that you could dilute the focus on that. So the timing of it is critical. Again, my view was on balance that in order to properly mainstream apprenticeships as an example, then it needs to be absolutely plugged into the mainstream of funding, qualification development, curriculum development and careers provision as well. But it might be, and I haven't stipulated in my report, but it might be that you need some safeguards in there, that there are certain thresholds of funding that have to be ring-fenced for, you know, certain parts of the system. But overall, I felt that by joining it up, you're more likely to end up with a joined-up system. Mm-hmm.
I'm grateful for the detail. Another risk that the committee has been alerted to is in, so University of Scotland made a very useful submission to us, and in that submission University of Scotland has suggested that if with a single funding body there could be a risk to the university's status, to the ONS classification and indeed their autonomy. With that move to a single funding body, which of course would have exactly the opposite effect in terms of restricting their ability to respond to the needs. Were you aware of that as a risk when you made your recommendation? And if so, why did you nevertheless make the recommendation? Yeah. And if not, does that cause you to reflect on whether that's the right recommendation going forward?
Yeah, so my understanding is that the creation of a single funding body in of itself does not present that risk. It is more about what the status of that body is, so NDPB or not. I deliberately didn't get into what the governance status of that body should be, in part because it looked like a bit like a rabbit hole and it was incredibly complex. So I walked from that. And the only body that I made a specific recommendation on in terms of what their legislative or governance status should be was the Future of Skills Development Scotland for two reasons. One, I was asked to do it specifically in the terms of reference. And secondly, I felt that the really quite unusual status of SDS as a public company limited by guarantee, rather than something established in statute or as an executive agency or NDPB, didn't feel appropriate for a body that's about delivering ultimately a public service and to be accountable to ministers. And I didn't take a view on what the governance status should be of the new funding body. But hopefully it would be taken as read that I wouldn't certainly want that body set up in any way which jeopardised ONS relationship or the status of universities themselves. So if that requires it to be an NDPB, I'll leave that to others who are better versed in public sector models for agencies. But if that's what it requires, then that's what it requires. But I don't think that is the argument itself, that you shouldn't bring funding together under one body.
Very grateful. Convener.
Thank you very much, Liam Kerr. And can we move to Bill Kidd, please? Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Convener. And thank you, Mr. Withers, for interesting background and for the review, of course. On the back of what you've just been talking about, the review did suggest setting national priorities. It didn't actually set them itself, but it did suggest that these are important. So you might not want, just in what you've said, you might not necessarily want to point the finger at who should actually be taking responsibility to do that. But what are your thoughts on how these priorities could and should be divided and what should be taken into account, please?
So I think this recommendation, as much as anything, really lands government with a difficult one. Everyone agrees with prioritisation until you're not a priority. So this will be challenging, and not least for different sectors of industry. I used to work in food and drink. The idea of food and drink wouldn't be a priority would be a declaration of war to businesses in my old sector. I think it needs to be done on the number. So who should make the decision is one question. Obviously, we have a National Strategy for Economic Transformation and an NSET delivery board. I think they have a pivotal role. But one of the reasons that I recommended not only the establishment of a network of regional employer boards, but also a national employer board is to help inform that. So I think it needs to be informed by business. I also think it needs to be informed by third sector and other groups, but it will come down to a political call, really, as to how you establish those priorities and for how long does a priority remain a priority. My observation on NSET is that having a longer-term 10-year horizon for economic ambition is a very, very good thing. My criticism would be it sort of prioritises everything that currently exists and everything that's coming down the line, which we're coming down the line, which doesn't feel like prioritisation. So I think there's a need to really define what are the areas of Scotland's competitive advantage. And I would add alongside business voice, insight and foresight in where the economy is going. But identifying where does Scotland have competitive advantage, competitive strength, where does it have competitive opportunity, and what are the areas of significant change that are going to affect the four corners of Scotland. So whilst I haven't been brave enough myself in asking other people to be brave, I haven't been brave enough myself in identifying what they are. You know, the transition to net zero, I would probably use an example of maybe something that would be in there. But at the moment, what we have is lots and lots of reference to green skills. I don't know what they are. No one's really actually drilled down to say what they are.
Well, just on the back of that then, government, for instance, is normally people's idea about who takes eventual responsibility on many things. but do you think that should be led along a path of working with other organisations and groups in society who have experience of the green skills elements and of the business elements, and working together in some sort of way of bringing responsibility together across a board before it is then put into policy?
Yeah, I think there's a real strength to doing that. So if I just to quickly think about my experience in food and drink, government used to write the industry strategy for food and drink, which didn't make any sense to me. You know, government have their role. It doesn't strike me their best place to write a strategy for any industry. So, but that can be quite easy for industry to allow to happen, because then when things go wrong, it's government's fault. There's no ownership of it. So I do think there's an important principle about industry and business taking ownership of their own strategic direction. How you embed that kind of structure into day-to-day government work, I suppose, is something governments wrestle with, and you have advisory boards, and you have steering groups, and there's stakeholder groups by the dozen that help inform that. But I think it is a valuable part of the approach. The other thing I think that is really important is the need to compare approaches with other countries, comparator nations. You know, we're very obviously, patently not the only small country trying to work out how to transition to net zero. So I think that relationship with other EU countries, I'm more broad on that. Certainly when I did my work, I looked at Germany and Switzerland and Singapore, Ireland, in terms of skills systems elsewhere. And I think, again, in food and drink, most of the good things that were done and most of the successes were ideas taken from elsewhere.
That's very helpful. Thank you very much indeed for that.
Thank you. Thank you. Mr. Withers, you mentioned at the very outset about how at the beginning of your review process, AI wasn't anything people were talking about, but now it's all people are talking about. So I'm curious, as you know, as your review is sitting there, how adaptable is it to the real pace of change that we see happening externally?
So I would probably use that to justify why I didn't pick my winners in terms of priorities, because it does move at a rapid rate. For me, what I was hoping to do and hopeful has made some contribution towards is thinking about how you build a system which can then pivot, absorb to whatever the priorities or opportunities or challenges might be of a particular day. Mm-hmm. So one of the free, and you know, I tried to follow evidence in the work that was done between myself and the kind of secretariat that supported me, and it was clear within that people wanted a system that was more agile and flexible. Now, that's easy to say, and it is really difficult to deliver, but having a system which particularly puts greater autonomy and ownership on places, regions, to determine what's right for them, allows them to pivot into as an opportunity. You know, a big inward investment is made in an area, a company lands, it needs a particular skills requirement, free up that system to allow them to work more agile. And regionally, they will work more agile than I think they can nationally. So my hope would be that in taking a whole system approach and building a system, you build something, a machine in a sense, that can build in agility, flexibility, and can be free to move with changing priorities and changing opportunities.
No, thank you for that. I suppose I wondered if there's anything that you were hoping to be able to present to us this morning that you've not had the chance to say. I know that's a bit of an open question there, but
I don't think so. I think the kind of culture of reform we have touched on. To be honest, I think we've kind of covered most of the areas. I do think that. I think, which was a focus on your first panel, I do see the educational reform and reform of curriculum, what's happening in schools, is absolutely integral to the broader skills piece. I mean, it's obviously cliche to say it all, you know, start it as young as possible. But the whole parity of STEAM piece and equity of learning opportunity is the ball game in all of this. And culturally, practically, and financially, the system doesn't embed that. It serves too small a proportion of both the pupil population and the wider population of the country. And, you know, a system that does that in a country like Scotland, whose working age population is shrinking, ONS thinks our population will shrink faster than any other part of the UK. The immigration situation is different now we are out of the European Union. The need to make the most of the skills and potential of the population we've got requires us to reform the education system as well as the post-school skills and learning environment. So I do think the two go hand in hand, and I think there's a lot of good in certainly what Professor Haywood's proposing that I could certainly relate to in what I've seen.
So what do you think that the Scottish Government should do next?
So I go back to establishing the vision for what good looks like. That needs to be the North Star. So we're clear where we're headed. I think it needs to... I caught the end of the last panel, which said you're never going to achieve consensus. So give up on that and be bold and take some decisions. In the certain probability, there will be people that will be very upset and nervous about that. In my experience, the people who will be upset, nervous, discombobulated by that will not be customers of the system. They'll be people that are involved in the delivery of the system. Care less about them would be my message to government. So I think keep the momentum up and try and make momentum unstoppable. And that means setting that vision and start putting in some of the early steps. And I've identified five that I think that could be done to try and make it much more difficult to reverse out a reform than it is just to carry it on.
No, that's super. Thank you very much, James. And I'd like to thank you for your contribution today, obviously. This concludes the public part of our proceedings, and the committee will now consider its final agenda items in private. I'll suspend the meeting to allow Mr. Withers to leave. Thank you very much.
Thanks.